a tremendous amount of murder is going on. But we are going to get to the bottom of... Yes.
Oh, where's the... We have a sharpened man.
We have the sharp... Oh, a sharpener?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've got one of those. Hi, let me get the pencil sharpener. Wait, let me move the music first. There we go. Okay, good.
Oh, sorry.
Here we go. No, we're good.
We're live. I want a pencil sharpener.
Goodbye. Hi, welcome to the Pencil Sharpening Show. My name's Fox Sound. I'm sharpening your pencils today.
Thank you so much.
Wow. Ooh, that's sharp.
Wow, nice. It really works well.
It's good. I really value a pencil sharpener. Hey, can I interest you in a sharp pencil?
Sure.
Cool. Just...
Have you never used an electric...
No, you have to hold it still.
Oh.
Otherwise, you're just going to literally just grind the entire thing down.
Destroy. I haven't used a pencil sharpener in maybe
20-some
years.
Yeah.
That's
like,
amazing.
I like mechanical pencils usually.
Yeah, no! They have all the wrong heft. Number two, wooden Ticonderogas for life. Lovos, can I interest you in a sharpened pencil? You want to get that good. Fine grain. That's delicious.
That's going to work.
That's the rule.
Where's mine?
What were you going to put in there?
Oh, the pen?
Whatever she had in her hand, regardless of what it was.
Fingers.
No, that's like one of my greatest fears. I hope Moriarty... No! I hope Moriarty doesn't find out about it. We'll find out as we continue our adventures. Searching...
Why is there a Roman coin in this pencil sharpener?
Oh my goodness, we're rich. Yes. This week's episode of Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective is the Thames Murders. How do we say that word?
Thames?
Thames?
I think it's a Thames.
Thames?
I've heard it Thames.
Thames. This sounds like a job for pronunciation guy.
Yeah.
I don't think it's T. I don't think it's the. I'm pretty sure it's a hard T.
I'm pretty sure
Thames.
I'm pretty sure Thames. Thames is what you say if you want to irritate people.
Well, that's why I know that one.
Well, we're on twitch.com. What else would
it's
we
like
be
It's like saying
here for?
Tortilla.
I knew a guy
Thames,
that said
Kappa.
Amarillo for the longest time. For that color, which is not how you say that color.
It is not.
Bernay. Yeah. Or Maynard or Guadalupe.
Guadalupe is really bad.
Oh, that's really bad.
I refuse to call
that. Austin jokes. How to say Thames from British pronunciation. Learn English channel.
Why is it a minute long video?
Oh, that's a great question.
Oh my god!
Woo! Oh my gosh.
Oh, wow.
Why is it a minute long?
I heard say.
Don't keep us in suspense, man.
Thames.
Oh, fuck Thames. Off.
Thames.
Thames. I told you.
Thames.
That's not how that's spelled
Thames.
At all.
Thames.
I told you Thames.
You know what? Fuck the British.
The River Thames flows through London.
Yes, we heard you the first time.
That's so great. That's so good. That's great content.
I'm so
Do they
excited.
Have like a video like that for every word and proper noun in British English?
Every single one.
Thames. That's like Timotei.
Oh no.
Just that over and over again. Inside jokes. 4 of June, 1890, only a couple of months past our previous episode. Case 8, the Thames Murders. Oh my goodness, this is so
Thames.
Great.
I'm not going to say that.
Thank you. Billy holds the door open for us as we enter the familiar surroundings of 221B Baker Street. Here are our friends now, Gregson. Come in and take the chairs here at the table. After his greeting, Holmes settles back into his chair and waits for us to take our seats across from him and Inspector Tobias Gregson of Scotland Yard. I believe you know my friends, Gregson. Yes, of course. Gregson nods his head towards us in greeting. Watson, could you bring some tea over for our friends?
Of course, Holmes. My pleasure.
Watson, who has been standing by the sideboard, brings over the teapot and cups and joins us at the table. I have asked you here to Baker Street today to hear the inspector's facts on the series of murders that have taken place over the past week. The newspapers are calling them the Thames Murders, since all the bodies have been found in or near the
Thames
which is a river that flows through London. That's what, yes. Okay. Did you not know that?
No,
were you not listening to the YouTube video?
Is there something under?
Oh my goodness, how could you? There's my pencils, but they're not sharpened.
Thames.
I'll sharpen it.
Inspector Gregson reaches into his pocket and pulls out a notebook. Laying it on the table in front of him, he opens the book and looks at a few of the pages before addressing us.
I hope you'll be able to give us a little help on this one. I'm involved in two other cases of President Lestrade seems to be at his wit's end.
Holmes shifts in his chair and starts to speak, satisfies himself with a knowing smile.
Early this morning, continues Gregson, the body of Roland Jacquard,
J-A-Q-U-A-R-D,
was found near the Charing Cross footbridge on the south bank of the Thames. He had been badly beaten, and bruises around his neck suggest that death was caused by strangulation. As you probably know, this is the fifth body found in the Thames or its banks in the last week. So far, no connection has been found among these murders. Sorry, not laughing at murder. Paul is hitting
yeah,
me with...
Paul is.
Paul is so excited about foreign words.
Yes.
He's using his Chun-Li kicktail maneuver. Mm-hmm.
So far, no connection has been found and none may exist, but this is what I want to find out.
What can you tell us about Jacquard?
Roland Jacquard, 36, was the stepson of Lord Astley Denham. His father, General William Howard Jacquard, was killed during the Indian Mutiny. His mother, Lady Margaret, married Lord Denham in 1860. She was one of the leading ladies of London society. Roland had the reputation of a ne'er-do-well. Some would even say a mountebank. Thames. His only visible means of income was his ability with cards. He was one of the best whist players in London and could be found most days at the card table of the Bagatelle Card Club, 14 Poland Street, Northwest. He could also be found in the drawing rooms and sometimes the bedrooms of some of the best families in London.
Bedrooms? You mean he's a womanizer? asks Watson.
That was part of his reputation.
Holmes, who has been quiet during Gregson's discourse, now turns to the inspector. Have you made any progress on the other murders?
None that I know of. As I said, Lestrade has been conducting the case, but very little progress, if any, has been made. I can give you the names of the other victims, if you like.
That would be a start, says Holmes, one of the three people in the room. Well, counting us, I guess, 15. As Gregson looks through his notebook, Holmes turns his attention to us. This case presents some interesting possibilities for you. We don't know if there are any connections within the series of murders, but I don't believe in coincidence. Five bodies in 6 days found in or by the Thames is too much coincidence for me. Remember, we must look for the underlying logic of a crime. No matter how diabolical the criminal mind, there is usually a logic to it. That's what we must find. Have you found the victims' names yet, Inspector?
Yes, here they are. I have made a list for you with the victims' names and the dates of the murders. Here it is. Gregson hands us a list. I'll display it momentarily.
I hope you'll be able to help us in this matter, Mr. Holmes.
Unfortunately, Watson and I are involved in a complex little problem that we must bring to a conclusion, but we will give as much assistance as we can.
What could be more pressing than five murders, Holmes? Many things, Gregson. Many things. But I'm not uninterested in this case and will give it as much attention as I can. I'm sure that our friends here will be able to shed some light on your problem. The names of the other murders are...
Theo
Shepherd. Sherlock Holmes!
What?
No. Nathan Revell on the 30th of May, Cyril Maud on the 31st of May, one Charles Attard, two T's, on the 1st of June, Leo Shepherd on the 3rd of June, and Roland Jacquard on the 4th. They are here. Yeah. Technology.
I'm gonna cheat with my future tech.
Do it, do it. From here in the future.
Once we have finished with this, there are at least two newspaper articles that are of relevance.
Aha!
That's how I knew what one of the names was before.
Is one of them a confession from a murderer?
Unfortunately, not that helpful, it seems. But something you will definitely find interesting, I trust.
Is it a cry for help from the moon?
I don't think so, unfortunately.
Oh, I'm the moon. I want to be in orbit.
I miss you so much. Hi, Yumzy. So we're playing Sherlock Holmes Consulting Detective. We did a good job of like reminding people what the game is when we start. I think we've fallen out of it in recent days. So what we've got is we've got a murder, several murders, as a matter of fact, told to us by the introductory text. And then we have a map of London. and it is our jobs as the protégés of the master detective Sherlock Holmes to help him solve the case by figuring out, well, we should go check out the scene of the crime, or we should investigate the place where the murder victim lived, or we should talk to the cops and see if they know anything about it. And then we look up where it is on the map that you want to go, and then you figure out which sector of town and which number that corresponds to. And then you flip to the relevant paragraph in the murder book. The murder book. The murder. What a sinister... Jeez. Step aside, Death Note. It's time for murder book. And then it gives you some information. And maybe that information gives you another clue. Maybe it gives you a red herring. Maybe it gives you nothing. But then you figure out what you want to do next until you think you have enough information to solve the case. And then you try and solve it. So... Oh, you were going to read some...
Yeah.
That's another thing. There's newspapers for every single one of these dates where we're investigating a murder. Please.
Alright. First article on the front page. Another body found floating in the Thames.
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 Thames is a rough river that flows through London. Shortly after 11 o'clock last night, another body was found floating near the Selmwark Bridge. The deceased, a man in his middle 30s, has been identified by seaman's papers found on his person as Leo Shepherd. Shepherd had apparently been shot. This is the fourth victim found murdered in the vicinity in the past 5 days. The inhabitants of Southwark are becoming increasingly anxious as to the discovery and apprehension of the perpetrator or perpetrators of these crimes. Although at least one of the victims was known to be a bad character to associate with others, most another character.
Bad character. Like he had subpar stats?
I love the way they put it sometimes. Anyway, the list of victims includes a barrister and a senior clerk from the firm of Lindsay & Company.
Oh.
Police are much attacked as a consequence of their not having any suspects at this time.
What was the name of the company?
Are they murdering the police?
L-I-N-D-S-A-Y & Co.
Not Lindsay & Son.
And what was the bridge?
Southwark Bridge.
Southwark Bridge.
Is that where they were all found, or?
That was Leo Shepherd, right?
Near the bridge. Yeah.
Southwark Bridge.
Let's see.
You said you had another story for us, right?
Yeah, just making sure I didn't miss any. Oh wait, there's three at least about the things.
My goodness.
Oh. I'll read this other one first.
It's Tim's.
Tim's. Tim's, sorry. Tim's investigation continues. The investigation continues into the series of murders which have been plaguing the Bankside Southwark area during the past several nights. Sunday's murder, the third in this recent outburst of violence, came as a shock to the community. Mr. Charles Hatter, a well-known London barrister, was gotten behind a waterfront warehouse in Upper Round Street, brutally murdered. He had been shot twice with a large caliber gun. The absence of Adder's wallet points to a possible motive of robbery, but the police have given little additional information to the press. And now we have a letter to the editor. Sir, with regard to the suggestion...
I'm the Thames. Please stop throwing your bodies at me. Sorry, please go ahead.
Of course. Sir, with regard to the suggestion that bloodhounds might assist in tracking the Thames murderer, as a breeder of dogs and knowing their power... This is good already.
Hello.
If only you knew the power of the dog side.
Hold on. I have little doubt that had a hound been put upon the scent of the murderer while fresh, at least in those cases where the body was not actually floating in water, it might have done what the police had failed in. I've made some experiments in this area myself, but Scotland Yard does not appear interested in my results. But now, when all trace of the scent has been trodden out, it would be quite useless. Meanwhile, as no means of detection should be left untried, it would be well if a couple or so trained bloodhounds, unless trained they are worthless, were kept for a time at one of the police headquarters ready for immediate use in case their services should be called upon. There are doubtless owners of bloodhounds willing to lend them, if any of the police, which I fear is improbable, know how to use them. I am, sir, your obedient servant. Sherman, 6 Hollywell Road, London, EC.
I thought you were going to say it was written by a bloodhound.
Hi, sir, your obedient servant. Polo.
Polo? You're so British.
Is there anything else? I don't see anything else jumping out at me about the Thames specifically.
May I?
Yeah, go ahead, please.
As it happens, there's at least a collateral piece of information we may find interesting, that there is a whist tournament from Wednesday next to Saturday, open to players and spectators, grand match for £200, Bagatelle Club, 14 Poland Street, Northwest. A frequent hangout of our mountain bank murder man.
So, not necessarily relevant, but just to note that the third and second to most recent kills were guns, and then the one that we're mostly investigating was strangulation, but who knows?
Also beaten, too, by the sound of it.
Beaten?
What is the one about Charles?
That was a little one on the back, I think.
Clearly our murderer used up all of his bullets on the other.
There it is, yeah.
Oh, thank you.
I hope that's like ends up being a thing, like he was out of bullets, so he had to punch him to death.
Darth Vader, no!
Well, following
he's marking the strangulation location. No, actually that was the other one.
Following the well, if ever there was an avatar for strangulation, it would be the Dark Lord of the Sith. Following our instincts from previous cases, it may do well for us to speak to the gossip columnist about someone who has a reputation.
I was about to say,
is this before the crime scene?
Oh, not necessarily before, but certainly we should keep it on our list.
Yeah, the society columnist seems super relevant for that last guy.
Yes.
Do we have a crime scene location? They say it's Southwark Bridge,
said
right?
Behind a warehouse on Upper Ground Street.
I thought that was Charles Saturday.
That was Charles.
Yeah.
Right. We're investigating
Roland
Jacquard.
It said the south bank of the Thames.
Yes.
Yeah, not like more
near the bridge.
Like there's a location there, but who knows?
No, they said something. They did give something close to a location, didn't they? They gave
there
a street.
There was a bit of a
Charing Cross footbridge. Charing Cross is.
What cross?
Charing? Charing Cross.
Okay.
I think maybe a visit to the station would probably be our best bet.
I can go with that. Seems a little distant from the...
Yeah, the others.
Maybe it washed down the river.
Possibly.
Maybe it washed up the river.
Whoa. It's already crazy.
Here we go. Here's our shooting. Maybe it was... Here's our strangulation.
Oh, no. Well, if ever there was an avatar for getting eaten by a hell beast. Well, Charing Cross Station is at 21 WC. Who'd like to start us off?
Yay! Thank you. 21 WC?
Certainly.
This is an unusually thick one, unless I'm forgetting the weight of previous books. Did it feel that way to you?
There's a lot of murder.
21 WC.
Where
the WC is.
Yes, perhaps there's a separate casebook for every murder.
21
W. No, nothing.
21 WC, right?
21 WC.
Absolutely zilch.
Charing Cross Footbridge.
Footbridge, though, like...
Well, presumably that's this bridge here that you can walk across.
Yeah.
Maybe not. I don't know.
Yeah, so maybe it's just... I mean, that's why I don't... It doesn't seem like we have actual location.
92 or no?
92.
Doesn't hurt to look, right?
In a case where we're uncertain of the crime scene, maybe the police could narrow it down.
Yeah. The last thing I want to do is go to a location and have them be, it's across the street, or whatever.
I love it when that happens.
So cheeky.
Yes, perhaps visiting the coroner or something like that to
We should definitely go to the coroner because we got a whole bunch of bodies.
So I'm curious how the first two died. There's no information on that yet.
Yeah.
Well, that would of course be Sir Jasper Meeks at St. Bart's. 38 EC.
Good old Jasper.
38 EC.
Yep.
Cats.
Oh boy, I'm going to be here a while.
38
Playing the game?
Reading the almost page and a half entry.
My goodness!
Alright, 38 EC. Here we go. We entered the office of the coroner of London and find an exhausted Dr. Meeks slumped behind his desk.
38 EC.
Well, I hope you will be able to do something about this series of murders. A murder a day is too much. If it keeps up, I will be lying on the table instead of standing over it. Did you do the autopsy report on Roland Jacquard, Doctor? Yes, I performed all the autopsies. Sorry, it's gonna be funny, alright. I perform all the autopsies of her victims, only God knows why. I spend hours over the reports and what happens to them. I send them down to the yard and they don't even read them. Just file them away. Oh well, what can I do for you? What can you tell us about the so-called Tim's murder victims? Well, let's see. Sir Jasper starts to sift through what looks like disorganized piles of paper that completely cover his desk, but within seconds he comes up with what he's looking for. Okay, here we go. First victim, Nathan Riddell, was brought in around midnight, May 30th. I often worked a late shift and did the autopsy at that time. Riddell was a white male, about 50 years of age, 5 feet 6 inches tall, 220 pounds. He was not in good health. Bad lungs, bad heart. It was just a matter of time, 6 months to 2 years, and one of his diseased organs would have caused his death. His death on the 30th of May, however, was caused by 2 gunshot wounds in the back. It was a large caliber gun fired at close range. One bullet, which I believe was the first one, entered the midsection of the back, severed the spinal cord, and lodged in the heart. The other bullet entered the mid-back, angled down through the liver, and exited through the lower abdomen. I sent the bullet, what was left of it, and its personal effects to the criminology lab. So much for Mr. Riddell. Can you tell us the time of death? I would say between 9 and 10 p.m. on the 30th. Any other questions? No. Please continue. The next victim was Cyril Maud, male, approximately 25 years of age, 5 feet, 3 inches, 135 pounds. His body came in only a few hours after that of Mr. Riddell's, and I performed his autopsy after I had finished with Mr. Riddell's. Mr. Maud was a strong young man, no organic diseases. He was killed by a long, sharp object that entered through the left armpit and went through his lung and into his heart. Very neat, professional job. Death was instantaneous. And how long had he been dead? No more than a few hours. I would place the time of death at around midnight, no later than 1 a.m. You had a busy day. All my days have been busy and late. What of Charles Attard? Charles Attard's body arrived at 10 p.m., June 1st. Since I had just finished another autopsy, I decided to go ahead and do his. I thought I'd get it out of the way and sleep in the next day. Charles Attard, age 52, height 5 feet 11 inches, 180 pounds. Good health for a man his age. Strong, good muscle tone. Death was caused by 2 large caliber bullets, one in the chest, the other in the abdomen. Not a pretty sight, but death never is. He was shot at close range, no other marks. Leo Shepard was the next fatality, age mid-30s, height 6 feet 2 inches, 210 pounds. A very strong man and one used to violence. Well, how could you tell that? His body was covered with scars, with a long one across his forehead. He had been shot twice before, stabbed a number of times. His body told a story of a violent life, and violently it ended. He had apparently received a flesh wound a day or two before his death. I removed a small caliber shot from his left shoulder, which I sent to Murray along with the bullets that hit him the night he died. From a large caliber gun. No. I removed 2 other small caliber bullets from his body, one from his neck, which did not cut any of his main arteries. The other I removed from his back where it lodged in his spinal cord. But it wasn't the shots that killed him. He drowned. So he was alive when he went into the water. Yes, the bullet that hit his spinal cord cut some of the nerves, so there is little doubt that he was paralyzed when he hit the water. Time of death? Between 8 and 10 last evening. Please continue. That brings us to the most recent casualty, Roland Jacquard. His body arrived at a little after 3 o'clock this morning. I had just finished the autopsy before you arrived. Jacquard was in his mid-30s, 6 feet in height, 170 pounds, good physical shape. He put up quite a fight. He was badly beaten, but from the bruises on his hands and knuckles, I would say he left some marks on the murderer. Death was caused by strangulation. Can you pinpoint the time of death? I would say between 1 and 2 a.m., not long after he had supped on pheasant and pate foie gras pie, judging from the contents of his stomach. Thanks, Doc. We'll let you get some rest.
Whoa!
There's a lot there to review, probably. Any specific questions?
So, latest one was strangulation.
After a beating.
Guy before that.
Small caliber shots.
Small caliber shots.
Drowned.
Paralyzed, was thrown in the river, drowned. Then the 2 previous were shot, large caliber.
Yep.
What was the first one?
No, Cyril Maud was the stabbed one. Stabbed through left arm.
Oh, excuse me.
Yes,
okay.
There wasn't one, the other was a stab between the 2
Got
shot
it.
Guys.
Okay.
And so we have 4 different methods of killing here.
Indeed.
The location is the same, but 4...
I almost wonder if Leo Shepard was, like, unrelated.
It's interesting. So the newspaper said two of them worked for a company, the same company.
Indeed,
which
Lindsay
two
and
two
company.
Are those?
I don't think the paper said, actually.
Oh, yeah, it didn't.
What?
Lindsay? Or Roland Jacquard?
Yeah, no, it said the company, but not which two worked for the company, maybe.
Would you want to go to, like, Jacquard's house and
it said,
see if
it said Leo,
wants to talk to us there?
Said Leo Shepard had Seaman's papers. Yeah. Is that for Lindsay and Company? Is that a...
No, it was a throwaway line in this one. It said, although at least one of the victims was known to be a bad character to associate with others of similar character, the list of victims includes a barrister and a senior clerk from the firm of Lindsay and Company. Although that may mean a barrister and then a senior clerk from this other company.
Yeah.
I may not mean both are from the firm of Lindsay and Company, but...
Maybe so.
So I kind of vote we check out the criminology lab because he has like a bunch, all the bullets and stuff.
He's had a busy day too.
Yeah.
it does seem weird to me that one murderer would choose four different weapons, different techniques. Some are very professional. Some like the beating and strangulation are clearly.
Maybe it's the Sinister Six.
Maybe it's definitely not something I've been to read for a while. So someone else can...
Where's that criminology lab?
That's, of course, H.R. Murray.
Pokemon?
22 Southwest.
Yeah, and I guess... It almost sounds like some of the victims could potentially be suspects in the murders.
Like, each one killed the last one.
Like the mummy, sort of, all over again.
Yeah,
they already did that gimmick. It's probably not that again. It's probably the Sinister Six.
Yeah, because they said Leo had a fresh, like, vision or something.
Yeah, although it's weird, because he was killed before the murder that involved the fight.
Wow.
You know?
That's true.
Like, I think you were right about this one being heavier than the others.
Yeah, I picked it up, I was like, this feels heavier.
It could be our first two-part episode.
Maybe.
We'll see.
Maybe there's a snake hidden in one of the clues.
Oh my god, I hope it's not a snake.
Monster at the end.
H.R. Murray bends over his cluttered desk, moving papers from one pile to another. Let's see. I've got those reports somewhere. Here they are. Number 694. That would be Nathan Revel. Who?
Yeah.
Number 694. Are those the personal effects of Nathan Revel? I'll have to check the log. He walks over to a table and looks through a book lying there. Here it is. Number 694. Revel. Nathan. Is that how you say it? Revel?
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 Maybe.
Let me get the numbers of the other names on the list that you gave me. A minute later, he is back with four more numbered boxes. That's everybody, he says as he lays the boxes down and returns his attention to the box labeled 694. Did you guys know that it's labeled 694? Let's see what we have here. The first thing he removes from the box is a piece of paper and a small envelope. Here's my report and the slug that was removed from 694's body. Yes, I remember. The slug is destroyed beyond recognition, but judging from its weight, it would have come from a large caliber gun of German manufacture. How can you tell that from an unrecognizable bullet?
The greatest science in the world.
You can't, but you can tell from the powder. He pulls out a man's overcoat and shows us two holes in the back. I found traces of brown or cocoa powder. As you may know, gunpowder throughout the ages has consisted of, goes on to say all the stuff it's consisted of. Well, cocoa powder is 80%, I don't know, KNO, is that potassium nitrogen? I don't know.
Polo's trying to help.
Yeah. The only manufacturer of brown powder for small arms is Krupp in Germany for use with Mauser T11.
Mauser.
The other thing of interest is a letter I found in 694's coat pocket. He shows us an envelope, the ink of which is now an illegible smear. This was quite a challenge. It is stamped, so he must have had it in mind to post. Can't make out the address, but here's what I got from the letter. Appears to say, Patterson, by the time you get this letter, I will be dead. The monies I took are in my room. I was in trouble and had choice. Now, retaking the only, I don't know, only way or something, and I hope this that you will something. I'll let you guys read it after if you want to try to see
what it
says.
Yeah, it's a picture. It's
a... Ah, I see.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fat-finger text.
Are you trying to tell us he committed suicide? I'm not trying to tell you anything. I am showing you what the letter said, nothing more. When Inspector Lestrade was here and saw the letter, he said, ah, suicide. I pointed out to him that it was a difficult feat for one to take one's own life by shooting oneself in the back. After pondering that fact for a moment, he seemed to agree that suicide was unlikely.
Surprised you got that far.
Lestrade is the best detective.
Let me see what else we have.
I know if I ever killed anyone, I'd want him investigated.
Yeah. Maybe we're the murderers this time.
Damn it.
That's why all the methods were different. It was all of us.
It's true.
Somebody slacked off and someone had taken up the slack. 12 were not the same way.
It was me.
Let me see what else we have.
The die was the moon.
No wallet, no money, just some personal papers. A bank book from the Bank of England. A membership card for the Bagatelle Card Club. Here's something interesting. An old Roman coin.
Is this all still 6 minutes?
Yes.
No, I thought they pulled the next one.
Just let me see what else we have.
Oh. Oh, okay.
Oh, so a membership club to the Bagatelle Card Club for Revel.
Yes.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah,
okay.
In the, what, a slip from the Bank of England or something?
Yeah.
Yeah, a bank book from the Bank of England.
I was waiting for the coin to show up, but when I think about who could organize people with that many different, you know, talents at murder.
Murray bends over another box that he had laid on the table earlier and briefly sifts through its contents. Oh, here it is. He pulls a coin from the box and we see that it is identical with the one found on Revel. A strange coincidence, don't you think? And who had this coin? 704, that would be Leo Shepard. Do you want to take him next?
We say yes.
No. Let's leave.
Maybe.
I try to romance Murray.
Yes, not much here. His shirt.
Minus 12 affection.
Murray holds in front of us a red plaid shirt that had seen better days. One bullet hole in the back, no powder burns, looks like a small caliber gun. Meek sent me 3 bullets he removed from the body during the autopsy. One entered the neck, leaving no mark on the clothing. Judging by their weight, I would think 2 are 30 caliber, and these copper jackets indicate a French make. The third, which I understand was removed from a wound received a day or two earlier, is not a type ordinarily used in a murder attempt. The rest of the effects consists of a wallet with 10 pounds, Siemens papers from Jardines, a pair of brown pants, and a pair of work shoes. That's about it.
I'm sure we've heard Jardines before. It's a shipping company.
Yeah, definitely.
Okay, what about Cyril Maud? Yes, 699. Real slim pickings here. Nothing but the clothes on his back. So many holes in his shirt that you wouldn't be able to tell which was made by the weapon if it weren't for the bloodstain. Looks like the hole was caused by a stiletto-type knife that went in under the armpit. Murray lays out the worn blue work shirt for inspection. An equally worn brown jacket and brown pants, along with a pair of cheap black boots, are the sole worldly remains of Cyril Maud. Not very interesting, is it? Well, let's look at 701, Charles Attard. I think you'll find something interesting here. Our friend, the Mauser T11. There is no mistaking that 11mm hole in the cocoa powder. 2 shots at very close range, one in the chest, the other in the abdomen. The second shot was unnecessary, to say the least. So you're saying that Revel and Attard were shot with the same gun? Unfortunately, I can't say that. The bullets are in no shape to be matched. They are soft-nosed bullets and flatten on impact, which makes comparison impossible. All I can say for sure is that they came from the same type of gun. Anything else of interest? Yes, a pepper box. A pepper box? Murray pulls out a small handgun with 6 barrels. Yes, a pepper box.
He's gonna shoot us!
An interesting little gun. American-made. Don't see them often. not the most logical design, and effective only at close range. It wasn't very effective for 701, was it? It has been fired 3 times, very small round shots. Not a weapon one would want to stake one's life on. 701, is it? The gun fires shots much like the one removed from Shepard's shoulder. I wonder if there might be a connection. Anyway, there's nothing else of much interest. No money or wallet, a broken gold watch chain, no watch. A well-made black suit and a very expensive pair of shoes. That brings us to our last subject, 706. The late Roland Jacquard, I believe. Not much I can tell you about this one. From Meek's report, it looks as if he were strangled and there's nothing in the physical evidence that would indicate otherwise. One spotless silk shirt, sans collar, very expensive, as are all the clothes in 706's box. A gray morning coat, black pants, and a pair of socks, one brown, one blue. A pair of French-made shoes, very expensive. And that, gentleman, is all there is of Mr. Jacquard in this box. No underwear, no wallet, no personal effects. Oh wait, there is a ring, gold and inset with a large ruby, again, very expensive. So, that covers all the boxes. Anything more you can tell us? Not that I can think of, unless you're interested in box 705. Murray reaches into box 705, which has been sitting to one side on the large table in front of us, and pulls out a blue house dress with a grotesque blood stain on its front. The final dress of Reinhard Lutz. It's not expensive, but tasteful. He wore no jewelry and carried only his German passport. Are you interested? No, thank you. I think we have enough murders to keep us busy for the moment.
I'm interested.
A German passport? So, it sounds like Leo Shepard killed, or, Charles Addard shot Leo Shepard. So did Leo Shepard kill Charles Addard and in the scuffle was shot with that pepper box gun or whatever?
So it may be that, Leo Shepard is, I guess he could be the Mauser guy then, potentially. Because both of those murders took place before he was killed. And he was killed with a small caliber gun.
Yeah,
so that might make sense if Leo Shepard is... Mm-hmm. Although one of them... Well, here's...
Two small caliber guns, though.
Right.
Yeah, there are two... Yeah, yeah. He was shot... Well, he was shot by the person who didn't murder him.
Yeah.
First, and that sounds like it was the man who had the pepper box.
Mm-hmm.
So were there two Roman coins, or was it? And were
Nathan and Cyril? Was it?
I thought it was Nathan and Shepard.
Nathan and Shepard, yeah.
Nathan Shepard. Oh,
okay. That's interesting because that would imply. Yeah. Okay, check this out. That's my email, which doesn't exist because we're in the 1800s. So Ravel was killed by the large caliber and had a coin. Mm-hmm. And then Shepard had the coin, which we're saying.
Mm-hmm.
Addard was also killed by large caliber, right? So if Shepard was ordered by Moriarty to kill Ravel and carried it out as ordered, got into a scuffle, somehow was, for his own purposes, going after Addard, took the shot from the pepper box, then killed Addard with his, signature gun, but that was not part of the plan.
Right, the Moriarty
He went thing. Off the script, and then he was killed.
And he just had one on him, because...
Well, he was killed...
Oh, I guess he could be killed.
Yeah, and then and that Moriarty's was basically Moriarty saying, don't go off script, like this guy. Look what that'll give you. Even if you're huge and have a huge gun, I will take a small gun and paralyze you and then you'll drown.
A possibility, but I don't think we have enough information about these gentlemen.
I just love speculating.
One question I want to ask. Who had the watch chain but no watch?
And that was Charles Addard, but...
Oh, and while I'm speculating wildly, I think the condition of Jacquard's clothing is extremely interesting. He had no underwear and mismatched socks,
definitely
but he dresses very nicely.
Well, yes. Yes, I think so. So maybe.
Also, I think he was the one that was beaten, wasn't he? Or that,
yes.
He was the one that was beaten and strangled.
Yes.
That definitely sounds more like a.
It didn't.
Not planned well thing.
Yeah. Maybe a hot pursuit by someone who found him in the act.
Yes.
That sort of thing.
Yeah, I'm imagining he got caught with the lady. Mayhaps.
Yeah, that's. A tar or
well, he found the
gem on your wallet, a broken gold watch.
He was beaten to death by it.
So the reason I ask about the watch is in the personals here, lost gentleman's gold watch attached to a lady's gold chain between Clerkenwell and Bloomsbury, December 29th.
Right? Interesting.
December 29th.
Yeah, £10 reward, communicate TB 21 Ampton Street, West Central.
I'd be interested.
Wait, 21 West Central, we actually looked up. Oh, wait a minute, though. We looked it up because it was
Yeah, right there. Yeah.
That's exactly where we went. Yeah.
Yeah, we went there and there was nothing there, but interesting.
Yeah, weird.
But was it that had the watch? I'm sorry?
Addard.
Addard is missing his watch.
Charles Addard.
But we, by accident, happened to go to that address already and know there's nothing there.
Might just be a bonus thing, like who's... had a stolen watch.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Maybe this is who really owns the watch and Addard has it for other reasons. I think that we need to know a lot more about the character of these men before we start putting the dots together.
Yes.
I think that perhaps the card club might be a good place to find information about more than one of them.
Yeah. Yeah, that was a lead in the beginning anyway, so.
That's
14 Poland Street, was it? 14 Northwest?
Mm-hmm. I think you're right.
Yeah, let's look at it to make sure.
Yep, 14 Northwest.
14 Northwest.
Cards!
Another hefty read. Alright. I'm sorry, this is a private club, and I can't let you enter unless you are a member or the guest of a member.
I'm a member.
Oh, well, come on in.
Too.
Oh. No dogs. We just want to talk to the manager about the death of one of your members.
Where are the dogs going to play poker?
I think dogs should vote.
Oh my god, this is... wait here, please.
Sir, come back.
Wait here, please, as the doorman goes back inside. He closes the heavy oak door barring our entrance to the Bagatelle Card Club. A few minutes later, he returns and ushers us in. Mr. Chapman will see you. This way, please. We are led into the spacious playing room of the club. To the left side of the room stands a large, ornately carved bar. The white-coated barman is busy serving drinks to half a dozen members who are standing by the bar's brass rail. The rest of the room is filled with card tables. Their green felt surfaces give a pastoral feeling to the room, which is enhanced by the silence of the occupants. 10 of the 30-some tables are in use, and the room's silence is broken only by periodic bids from the players and the clicking of their whist markers. Mr. Chapman's office is on the far side of the room. He's waiting for you. We walk across the playing room to the office door marked Roger Chapman, private. We knock at the door and enter after an answering voice bids us to. Roger Chapman is a large, affable man. His thinning, sandy brown hair is neatly trimmed and frames his ruddy face. Come in, gentlemen. Take a seat. I understand you're investigating the death of one of our members. Which one? Roland Jacquard or Revel? We'd be interested in anything you could tell us which might shed light on either of these deaths. Well, of course, I have heard of their deaths, and they were both members of our club, but I know nothing of their murders. I don't know how I could help you. If you could answer a few questions, that may be of help to us.
Good lord.
I know, I just saw
this
that.
Show just... This is,
it's basically two full pages.
That's incredible.
Yeah. How long had they been members at the club?
Also, internet, here's what a whist marker looks like.
Thank you.
I would like to see.
All in.
Yeah.
Cool.
You lose.
Let's see. How long had they been members of the club? Let's see. I've managed the club for 10 years, and both Roland and Revel were members when I started. Did they know each other? Were they friends? Of course they knew each other. They often played together, but I wouldn't say they were friends. Revel was here almost every night. He loved a good game of whist. Jacquard was also here most evenings and most days, and they sometimes played together, but they were in different classes as players. How do you mean?
Well, I don't think it's a secret that Jacquard made his living at the card table. Like many players in this club, he was more interested in his winnings than in winning. Ravel was a good player, but not on the level of Jacquard, and Ravel didn't have the money to make it worth Roland's time to play with him. So you see no convection between the two deaths? No, of course not. Well, gentlemen, I would like to talk to you, but I have a lot of work to do on our new membership drive. By the way, do you play whist? No, sorry. Roger Chapman rises from his chair and shows us the door. As he opens it, he hails the first white-coated man that passes. Leo, would you take these gentlemen to the bar and see that they get anything they want and put it on my check? If you change your minds about learning whist, let me know. Good day. Leo takes us over to the bar and informs the barman of Mr. Chapman's offer. The barman returns with our drinks and introduces himself.
The name's Edwin. Are you new members?
No, we're here looking into the deaths of two club members.
You mean Ravel and Jacquard?
Yes. Anything you can tell us?
No, I don't think so. You see and hear a lot standing on this side of the bar, but it's best not to talk about it.
We lay a couple of shillings on the bar, which vanish as Edwin wipes the carved wood clean with his rag.
It's like... I'm not going to say anything. Perhaps 2 pennies to convince you. Oh.
It works like an expensive card roll. Your wife gets ridiculous tips on occasion.
I can tell you that Mr. Ravel had spent more time at the bar over the past month. Just about every night he had been playing with Mr. Jacquard and Moron.
Moron?
Colonel Sebastian Moron. He and Jacquard were thick as thieves, they were. When they played together, they had more than their share of luck. I remember when they started to play with Ravel. He would come over to the bar to celebrate by buying drinks for other members. As the weeks went by, his drinking went from celebration to drowning his sorrows.
You mean that Ravel was losing a lot?
I didn't say that. I'm a bartender, not a card player. I can only tell how people drink. You might want to talk with Adair. He was Ravel's partner from time to time.
Where can we find Adair? A-D-A-I-R.
Ronald Adair. He is the chap down at the end of the bar. The one with the gold vest.
We pick up our drinks and move down to the end of the bar and ask Adair about his knowledge of Ravel's card playing.
Yes, I knew Ravel. We were partners in a number of games.
I hope he sends this to someone else, so you're forced to go down another octave.
We were partners in a number of games over the last year or so. He was a good player, not as good as he thought he was. But that's not an uncommon misconception among whist players.
We understand that you were partners with Ravel against Jacquard and Moran.
Yes, a number of times. Jacquard and Moran are two of the best players in the club. Today they are a formidable combination, a challenge to any player.
And did you overcome this challenge?
At first, yes. Then our luck changed and it seemed like we could never win, no matter how good our cards were.
Do you think you were cheated?
Cheated? Of course not. The club members are gentlemen. Cheated? Out of the question.
Did you have a wager on the game?
Yes, a small one. A pound or two. Nothing important.
And Ravel?
I don't know. A wager between gentlemen is not something you talk about. A gentleman should never wager more than he can afford. I don't.
When was the last time you saw Ravel?
Let me see. He died on the 30th, so it would have been the night before, the 29th. Ravel and I were partners in a game with Moran and Jacquard. We played until midnight. Didn't win a game all night.
Ravel seemed upset. Isn't that right, Edwin?
What's that, Mr. Adair?
Responds Edwin, who had moved down the bar to refill Adair's brandy glass.
Last Thursday, around midnight, remember? Mr. Ravel came into the bar. Didn't he seem upset? Right, I remember. He downed 2 gins as fast as I could pour them.
Edwin glances up and down the bar before continuing in a low voice.
Then Colonel Moran joined him. They seemed to be having a disagreement. After Moran left, Ravel really tied one on, if you know what I mean. The next night Ravel was murdered, continues Adair. I had a drink here with Moran. He said he was waiting for Ravel. Ravel never showed what seemed to upset Moran. He waited until around 8 and then left. He told me to keep an eye out for Ravel, and if he came in to tell him that Moran would be at the Tankerville. The Tankerville? What's that? It's a private club and dining room. The best prime rib in London. You should try it. And what's the address? 34 High Holborn. When was the last time you saw Jacquard? Yesterday. I arrived here around 4 o'clock. Jacquard arrived shortly after, around 4:30. We had a couple of drinks together, and then we got into a game with a couple of other members. At the start of the game, Jacquard stated that he could only play for a couple of hours because he had theater tickets for 8 o'clock. Luck was with us. Jacquard and I were winning big. Our opponents kept raising the stakes to make up for their losses. That's the type of player Jacquard loved. The more they lost, the more they were willing to lose. Jacquard, always the gambler, decided not to go to the theater. Seen the show 6 times. I can play until 10 and still make my dinner date, he said. We continued to play and win. At 8:30, I remember the time because I had just looked at my watch. Jacquard received a postal telegram. After reading it, he jumped from his chair, saying, "Sorry, gentlemen, I must go. Unexpected business." This, of course, upset our opponents, who were down 150 pounds. Jacquard wouldn't be dissuaded, however, much to the anger of Newbury. Newbury? Merlin Newbury, half of our opposition, not the best loser in the world. Who else was in the game? Clifton Lovelace. Nice man. Always the gentleman. That's the last I saw of Jacquard. The place won't be the same without him. Have you seen Moran lately? No, I haven't seen him for the last few days. I hear he's on the continent. Thank you very much for your help, Mr. Adair. Don't mention it.
How is that spelled?
Adair?
Moran.
M-O-R-A-N.
So I was sure that we had heard that name before, and I haven't made a full sweep of the papers, but we did hear of him in the very first case that we investigated, as he was one of the members of the shooting competition way back in 1888.
What kind of gun did he use?
Well, presumably everyone used the same kind of gun for the shooting. It was probably a rifle of some kind. Hmm.
Did it say where he was from?
This was rifle work. Now it simply says Colonel Sebastian Moran.
That gives us Sebastian.
Right.
Yes, indeed. I think they mentioned that in... Yes.
Yeah.
60 yards, 7 shots, military positions... right. Hit 5 on the bullseye.
Because I've not been able to find him in our listing here.
If he's on the continent.
Tricky. Quite a number of names dropped there, though.
Yeah.
Yeah, all the dreaded continuities coming back together.
I wonder if any of them are...
At first, I wondered if he was if Moran was an alias, but I mean, he's.
If it is, it's a long running one.
Yeah. So I guess he may not live here.
He was in town back then.
Yeah, but they did have people visiting, right, to partake in the competition.
Yes, or half, the competitors were from town.
I think he's like stationed on like a military kind of place.
Could be.
Rather than having private residence.
Thinking about what the entertainment that Jacquard might have been off to, there's the Gallery of Mystery, Dean Street, Oxford Street. Mr. Robert Ganthony's Laughable Musical and Illusory Entertainment, twice daily at 3 and 8, until next Saturday evening when the gallery will close for the summer vacation.
Does it say how long it's been running?
Because
8 matches up. And he said he'd seen it 6 times. So.
Does not. Okay. But if it's been running...
Oh, no, he said 8.
He said he had
twice
theater
daily,
tickets.
3 and 8.
He had theater tickets for 8
o'clock. To make the 8 o'clock show.
But there was also the Moore and Burgess Minstrel Splendid and Attractive Entertainment at St. James Hall tonight at 8. Monday, Wednesday, and Saturday at 3 and 8. new engagements, Mr. T. Campbell, the great baritone, Mr. Joseph Ellison, the two brothers Medetti. Doors open at 2:30 and 7. Oh no, I'm wrong. There's yet another one at 8 o'clock.
Jeez.
Royal Academy of Music, 23, Tenderden Street, Northwest, instituted 1822, Royal Charter, 1830. Patrons, Her Majesty the Queen, and the Royal Family Principal, Dr. Owen Edwards. Half term begins June 20th. Next fortnightly concert, Saturday evening, June... Okay, so if that's every fortnight. No, I guess that probably wasn't it. Unless he saw it every fortnight.
Something he saw six times. Did it say that the other one, they were adding new acts?
Yes, the new engagements one is the music hall one. So,
probably not that one, since he's saying he saw it six times?
No, I was actually leaning towards that one. Really? Because if they're saying new engagements, that means it's been running for a while. Right?
Maybe.
True.
Don't even know if it's necessarily a relevant piece of information. Yeah. Just
I was wondering if we could go back and read that note in light.
Oh right, yes, we never looked at it. It's right here. I don't know if you want me to fold it.
Put it in front of the camera, and then some of us will photograph.
It's kind of hard to even...
Beautiful.
For the glare.
Enhance. Yeah.
It's focus. Really not...
Increase gamma. Sharpen more.
To.
Gaussian blur.
Frog blast the vent core.
Squeaky says 150 pounds from back then would be like 18,000 pounds now in 2016.
Holy crap! That's
like
a lot of
24,000 USD.
I want the USD.
I haven't lost enough money to you. You gotta come back.
When you started reading that note, all I could think of was the Dear Sister skit from SNL, which is, of course, the best SNL skit.
Oh, Dear Sister. Yeah.
Oh, maybe that's going to be the end of the mystery. We all get shot by each other. And Shia LaBeouf.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
I have a... I realized that my playlist of, like, basically YouTube videos that are just music for listening to at work probably contains both the actual last boss of Xenoblade, but then the high-quality rip version of the last boss of Xenoblade, which is that song, but with actual Cannibal Shia LaBeouf mashed into it.
Of course.
Who's the one that had this note?
That was 694.
Is it 694?
I think so.
Yeah.
We heard it over and over again.
Yeah, that's Rebel. Okay, Rebel. Which
he was the first one to die.
Billy, I am in awe of your detailed notes.
Yeah.
They're really good.
It's too much.
But thank goodness someone is keeping
those.
There's
like,
way too much going on
here.
Looked
at, when they looked at the note and thought he was suicidal, that seemed to fit the pattern of the guy spiraling into gambling debt, you know?
Yeah.
Sure.
He says, the monies I took are in my room. I think... Taking seems more like stealing as opposed to like winning.
Yeah, if there was anyone whose home I'd want to investigate, it'd be his.
Oh, I was in trouble and had no choice. Now I'm taking the only way out, and I hope that you will do the same.
It was addressed to who?
Patterson. That's
Patterson.
Right. We don't have a name for Patterson.
Yeah. So
we'll just visit every Patterson in the dictionary.
So, we've only been to three places, right?
So
yeah.
As a matter of fact, there's only two. Inspector Patterson and a Neil Patterson.
Mm. Highly unlikely it's not the inspector, but can't be sure of that.
Well, wherever we go, I want to make sure that I get to read for as long as everyone else.
Well, the society commonly calls
got
five targets for him.
Maybe so, maybe so.
Of course, the criminal history guy might have a lot to say about Mr. Scarred Up and Shut Up guy.
That's fair.
Ooh,
hello. Hello.
My hand.
So
Jacquard, however, is the one that we're investigating.
True.
Well, I guess we're investigating a connection.
Yeah.
I am.
Yeah.
So where do we want to go?
The
society column seems like a surefire.
For Jacquard, yeah.
I feel like we'll almost certainly get some information from him.
Yeah. Especially about a guy like that who's been... I mean, we even suspect strongly that he was running from... Something interesting.
It's interesting, though, the way he was playing cards on the day... Like, that was the day he was killed, right?
Yeah.
Like, he didn't seem to be...
They said the day before, right?
I guess that's the day before.
They said the last time I saw him was the day before.
If we're going with the theory that he got caught literally in the act and was chased off, then his activities earlier in the day weren't really...
Don't really matter.
Really
you're,
he was just like, ah!
Yeah, maybe the note was just like, come over, my parents aren't home.
Yeah, a different note,
yeah.
Oh yeah,
I
got up, it's like,
what's
I have
the, yeah, what's the blue dress from Reinhardt that we didn't investigate?
Not... yet willing to pin any significance on that just yet.
Yeah.
Could have just been amusing. Might have been connected.
Fair enough.
Difficult to say. It seemed to address it as a dress worn by a man. Is that correct?
Yeah.
Dress sometimes, back older days, referred to just clothing in general, though, right?
Hmm.
Like
maybe so. I thought they called it a dress.
Called it a blue dress.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Polo. Langdale Pike, the society columnist. Mm-hmm. To Southwest.
Blue dress or gold?
Oh goodness! All right, this is a chunk. I'll accept this. Langdale Pike is lounging on the mauve satin settee that serves as his office. Clustered around him are members of the Society's Club, who are hoping to hear the latest gossip. Disappointment shows in the faces of those who have not yet been mentioned, for one has not yet reached the high tanks of London society unless one is talked about by Langdale Pike. I told Lady Lynch that she shouldn't take her jewels to the seaside with her, but of course, going to the seaside during the London season is so de classe, what do you expect? You know the jewels are rather kitsch anyway. And she was getting more attention out of them now that they have been stolen than she ever did by wearing them. And of course, Lord Lynch is very happy about the insurance money. Lloyd's loss is Lynch's gain. At this pause in Pike's performance, we get his attention. Gentlemen, what wind of scandal has blown you to my nest? Something interesting, I hope. Please, leave us. I wish to speak to my friends alone, says Pike as he shoos admirers away. Come, gentlemen, sit. I hope you have something juicy for me. We were hoping to get something from you. Oh, of course, of course. But give and take, gentlemen, give and take. Now tell me who you were working for. Helping Holmes again. I always look forward to seeing my name in Watson's Chronicles. He never gives me enough credit, but stuffy old Watson doesn't like much like me. We would like to know what you could tell us of Roland Jacquard. Oh, Roland, is it? I should have guessed Holmes would be involved in the investigation of Roland's death. What would you like to know? Do you know anyone who would have a reason to kill him? Oh, my dear boy, the list would be endless. The problem is not who would want to kill him, but which one got there first. Half the husbands in London would give a sigh of relief at his demise, and all the women will cry, and that is just for starters. His skill at the card tables is legendary, but most of the men who lost to him could afford it. Roland was such a charmer, they did so gladly. It was an honor. Did he cheat? Only if he had to. You see, a good gambler is a joy to behold. He'll convince you that you are the better player, and it is just the luck of the cards that is against you. Roland could be the greatest entertainer. He would have you smiling as you handed over your money. A real charmer he was. Can you give us a few names from this endless list that you think might be better leads than others? Well, right at the moment, Roland's love life was on the wane. Most of his energy was going into a young actress named Leticia Garcia. Roland always had a weakness for the young, dark Latin types. Don't know why. There were always two types of women in Roland's life. Those that loved him and those he loved. Rarely were the two the same. He was still involved with Linda Randolph, wife of Vincent Randolph, the shipping tycoon. There have been some very unpleasant encounters between Vincent and Roland. He still sees Kathleen Lindsay, but I don't think there is anything but friendship between them. Oh, and we can't forget Alexandra Pokrovsky. Last year, while her husband was in Russia, Roland and Alexandra were the talk of the town. There was even talk of her leaving her husband for Roland, but that may be in past history by now. May have been, and now that Roland is dead, poor Roland. Do you know a Leo Shepherd? No. Charles Addard? Not Pettifogger. I have met him, a friend of Roland's. I don't know what Roland saw in him. I didn't like him. The legal mind lacks pulchritude. Creativity. Anything of interest to me. At least that was the case with Charles Addard. But I can't tell you anything about his murder. Don't worry about it. He was a bug. Nothing more. We get the point. What about Cyril Maud or Nathan Revel? Never heard of them. The names were in the paper. They were also murder victims. You and Holmes read the Volga crime news. I only read what I write. Indeed.
So can we... Is there any mention of Garcia in the theatrical...
Ah, excellent question. Do you have the latest?
This is the oldest, actually. Ah. The latest must be at that file.
That's the opposite. June, yes. Here, Lois, when did you investigate?
He was the one who was strangled and beaten, right?
Yes.
Yeah. While we're in
so it actually was Zangief.
Yes.
He angered the Russians, and he was the final atomic buster into the Thames.
Did we decide not to try to find Patterson?
No, I think we simply...
I think we decided that was a sure bet that would get us a longer thing to read.
Yes. Yeah. We were more interested in me being happy than finding out information.
Well, also, I really wanted to go there.
Yes.
Yeah. Seemingly, there was a... On June 3rd, there was panic at the Théâtre François. The performance was disturbed by an occurrence which resulted in panic shortly after 10 o'clock. The electric wires supplying the chandeliers came in contact. In consequence of the wearing away of the envelope, the light was consequently extinguished and several sparks fell among the audience. Panic ensued in spite of the efforts of the actors to reassure the public. Firemen on duty of the theater immediately communicated with the headquarters of the brigade and a steam fired engine was dispatched on the spot. The incident caused great excitement in the neighborhood of the theater. I don't know if...
Excellent.
Garcia.
The older one. I'm just trying to see if there is anything.
It's directly on the other side.
Oh, really?
On the right side.
Oh, yes. Elephant and Castle Theater. Miss Leticia Garcia appears nightly in the title role of Dorothy with scene painting by the inimitable Halls Craven. Well, there you go.
So we've been to a theater show 6 times. Was letting him skip at that time. Got a note and ran off. If we're investigating him, the theater or her might be the next course step on that course.
Maybe so. Brandon, inclination?
Sure.
To the theater!
To the theater!
Elephant. So if you get ABD bone too, so that we all got one.
Elephant und Castle, 13 SE.
Not maybe you could borrow one of Polo's. I'm sure he has ABD bone.
Let's see. It's like a moderate one. 13 SE?
Yes.
Yeah, mate. I knew Roland Jacquard.
My god, a talking elephant! Oh, just a regular type. Have you seen any lions?
Oh, man. A real dandy he was, always after them women. He was here last night to pick up Leticia. She wasn't the first he's been here for. Last year he was courting Amelia Lorenzo, that year's star. He liked them dark beauties he did. I refuse to read that character. No. Well, I mean, well, whatever. It's great.
Don't swear on stream.
Board games. So Miss Garcia and Jacquard were seeing a lot of each other. Yes, sort of. Not as much as Jacquard would have liked, methinks. Leticia is a fun-loving girl. She has many admirers, and she takes advantage of it. Mr. Jacquard wasn't the only man in her life, even though he wanted to be. Funny, isn't it? A man like Jacquard could have as many women as he wanted. I guess that's why he tried so hard to get the ones he couldn't have. He seemed to know quite a lot about the lives of these people. I've been a stagehand for 25 years, and I've seen many dramas unfold on the stage, but I've also watched them unfold backstage, and real-life drama is much more interesting. I studied it. Have your studies revealed who the other men are in Miss Garcia's life? As I said, she was a fun-loving girl, and she had fun with a lot of men, but there were 3 that she saw more than the others.
So many names.
I know, right? One was Roland Jacquard, who you know about. Of the others, Marco Escobedo, the pugilist.
Yeah!
was a frequent caller.
I love pugs.
As was Sir Lester Ogilvy? It split in half. Ogilvy. Yeah. Of course.
Ogre.
Yes.
Lester Ogre.
Man had layers. Of course, I only see the colors that come to the stage door. You have any idea who would have wanted to kill Jakar? No, I don't. I only watch the dramas. I don't write them. Thank you, Mr. Parrish. That was apparently Mr. Parrish's station.
Should we try to find Miss Garcia?
That's a bad idea.
Because it seems that Jakar went and picked her up before he was murdered.
I'm curious.
Ogilvy.
Oh, God.
Ogilvy.
There, now we know how to say it.
Oh, cool.
Thames. Ogilvy. Sorry, everyone.
Hello.
Yes, I think...
So Marco Escobedo, the pugilist.
What is a pugilist?
A boxer.
And Roland Jakar was beat up and strangled.
That definitely, in terms of who's got the weapons to pull that off.
The guns.
Fortunately, professionally, even if he has marks on him, which we were hoping to find on the murderer, that may not mean a whole lot on someone who fights regularly professionally.
Yeah.
That may actually make it harder to prove if it was him.
I just want to imagine that there was a cool boxing fight as part of it.
It would be good to know where he was that night or talk to him and see.
I think that's worthwhile.
He's the first thing we have close to a suspect, I guess. I mean, Although, at the same time, I'm curious, that's... Like, with everything that's going on in that guy's life, is that, the most likely motive for murder,
Given how he was found,
It was
a fairly unprofessional kill.
Actually, I'd say, almost that I suspect Ogilvy more, given that it was strangulation. Wouldn't a proper pugilist simply have punched him?
Punching's not, necessarily...
We're in the age of Marquis of Queensberry boxing rules.
Yeah.
I also wouldn't expect a pugilist to get beat up by an amateur, which is apparently what was implied. He got hit a lot by the guy.
Sure.
I mean, if he was fighting an amateur, he should have been able to win pretty easily.
But I guess I'm thinking that the strangulation is just, the finishing. Like, that's once you punched him into submission, then strangle him, then throw him in the river.
Maybe so, yes.
Because you're not just going to box a guy till he dies.
But I actually...
Sure.
I agree, still makes me think it's the other guy more, so because he got hit so much from what we heard about it, the injuries on his hands.
Oh, yeah. Well, actually, he could have... If he's injured on his hands, he could have just been, defending well. If you're throwing punches and just he's blocking, I don't know.
There's another reason to check out the other guy first.
Yes.
He has a bunch of marks looking like he was beat up. He definitely didn't get them fighting professionally.
That is also true.
Lester Ogilvy. Sir Lester.
Sir Lester Ogilvy, if that's who we want to visit, lives at 50 WC.
I think talking to Leticia is worth it, though, because
certainly.
Approaching them, they might not.
If we can even find her.
This is an interesting one. We are shown to a large room of Sir Lester's spacious London townhouse. The room is filled with glass cases, which are filled with eggs. At the far end of the room is a long workbench covered with eggs, some in bell jars, others in boxes or lying on the top marble top of the workbench.
It's been chopping up the moon.
In fact, Sir Lester could be called a true egg head, for it is not until he raises his shining bald head that we can differentiate it from the specimens that clutter the tabletop.
Oh my god.
Help.
I'll be right with you, tweets Sir Lester. Wait, tweets? Do I guess Twitter?
No.
I just received these specimens of...
It's a giant egg.
That I must prepare. What can I do for you? We understand that you are a friend of Leticia Garcia, is that true? Yes. Has anything happened to her? No. We are investigating the death of Roland Jakar. Do you know him? No. Letty has mentioned Jakar, but I never had the pleasure of meeting him. Sir Lester moves out from behind his work table, his eyes fixed upon two small, pale blue eggs that nestle in his outstretched, cupped hands. We now see that Ogilvy is as fragile as the eggs he collects. He is a little over 5 feet in height, and his weight cannot be over 8 stones. Can you open the case for me? The one to your left. Wiggins opens the case, which contains pale blue eggs like the ones Ogilvy cuddles in his hands. Yes, Letty has mentioned that man a number of times. You see, Letty is a popular girl. Many men are interested in her. At times, she can't handle it. After all, she is still only a child. That's where I
fit.
I am her confidant, her father figure. Someone she can come to when she needs advice. She often needs
needs advice. What if she told you about Jacquard? That he wanted to marry her? That he was demanding more and more of her time? She could not decide if she really loved him or was just infatuated with the idea that someone of Jacquard's family background could be interested in her. Sir Lester pauses as he adjusts his host of pale blue eggs. She is really in love with someone else, a man from her own village, but she did not want to give up her newfound freedom by marrying anyone at this time. And who is the man she is in love with? Marco. Marco Escobedo.
Marco!
Needless to say, it doesn't sound like this guy beat up and struggled
with anybody. No, he hired someone.
What was
this
stone?
A giant egg.
20 pounds? The stone 20 pounds?
It was less than that, even.
Yeah.
Well, should we go see Marco, or should we look for Letty?
Marco!
One stone is 14 pounds.
14.
He's barely over 100.
8 is 112.
Yeah.
You guys think Marco?
I think it's worth a shot.
Yeah.
You're great.
Hey, did you murder that dude? Yes. Okay, bye.
See you next time. We arrive as Sherlock is arresting the man.
Damn it.
It's actually happened before.
Yeah, exactly.
Marco Escobedo can be found at 17 Southeast.
Anybody need water?
Actually, yeah. I've got a bottle on the counter. Thanks.
Okay, 17 Southeast.
But hey, if this guy felt the same way about her, he would definitely have plenty of motive to be upset if you called him the other guy.
What do you want?
Promising start.
What did you wake me up for? Mr. Escobedo, could we talk to you for a few minutes? What? Oh, come in. Marco Escobedo lets us into his small, sparsely furnished room. Escobedo's large frame makes the room seem even smaller. He is 6'3" and well over 16 stones in weight. One look at his face leaves no doubt of Escobedo's profession. Broken nose, ears like cauliflower, fresh bruises on his face tell us that he is still a practicing pugilist. What do you want? What can you tell us about Roland Jacquard? I know nothing about Jacquard's death. I didn't even know the man. But you knew who he was. Yes, I know of him. A ladies' man, and he was interested in my lady. Leticia Garcia? Yes, he was just using her. He didn't love her like I do. What difference does it make now? Where were you last night? I was in the gym, training until 8. I had dinner at Spaniard's Inn, and then I came home and went to bed. I have a big flight tomorrow, and I have to be in shape. Was anyone with you? No, I was alone.
Yeah.
Do you have any idea who would want to kill Jacquard? No, and I don't care. Would you please leave? I have to get down to the gym.
There's a big fight tomorrow, but he looks like he was just beat up.
Yeah.
Well, he probably fights on the regular.
Yeah.
Wait.
Oh, sorry.
I'm decorating, but I want to.
Oh.
But he did let slip.
Oh, yes. He screwed up a couple of things there.
Yes.
Hmm. Yeah. So we could at least alibi check Spaniards in. When did he die? When did?
I thought it was middle of the night.
The middle of the night. You got the.
Yeah, we can.
He checked the body at 3 a.m. or something like that. I can't remember.
Yes, that's right. He was brought in at like 3 in the morning, right?
But his time of death was.
I think it was like midnight.
Between 12 and 1.
Yeah, even if he was at the Spaniards Inn, that wouldn't necessarily.
I put one down and I drink. Well, we could alibi check him with. Well.
Let's go talk to Leticia first.
I think that's
let's do that.
Because our theory pretty much depends on Leticia and Jacquard being together that night.
But that doesn't explain what our connection is to these other murders, unfortunately.
Yeah, and they may not be.
Yeah.
Right.
I'm not sold on their connectedness yet. At least not a whole group of 5. I mean, some of them definitely sound connected. The two that were killed with Big Shot, the one little guy gun that was used on someone else. Those three I'm willing to.
The stab, the serial monster.
The stab is a mystery still. We are going to have to look.
Unless our knife man is actually still alive.
Maybe.
Yeah, it's possible.
We could. Oh, I don't know what the rules are on looking at old cases.
I think
I don't think you can look at old newspapers.
Leticia Garcia lives at 2 Southeast. Should be right up front.
2 Southeast. Leticia Garcia has the dark, sultry beauty of the Mediterranean race. She cannot be more than 20 years of age. Her youthful face is covered with tears, which have been streaming from her big, brown, bloodshot eyes. Yes, I knew Roland Jacquard. We were good friends. We had a lot of fun together, but I don't know anything about his death. When was the last time you saw Jacquard? Last 2 days ago. Do you have any idea who killed him? No, no, I've told you I don't know anything about it. Leave me alone. I have nothing more to say. So it's last, L-A-S, dot, dot, dot. 2 days ago.
I'm pretty sold.
Yeah,
she would certainly cover up for it.
Definitely, definitely.
And both of them have made pretty nervousy slips on it.
Yeah.
So I mean, I feel like in the absence of anything else, we probably know who killed Jacquard and even why. But we still have 4 more that we need to figure out.
Yeah, I would
have some progress on.
Yeah, yeah. I
would
almost.
Would you guys want to go to Tinkerville, which is where?
Oh yes.
Colonel Moran told the bartender to tell Rebel.
To meet him.
But maybe that is where Jacquard had taken Letty to dinner.
I think that makes sense.
Yeah. They're the part of the next set to investigate anyway, because they're the 3 that were involved with exchanging bullets in various configurations.
Maybe that's where all the bullets met for Prime Rib.
Prime Rib.
Oh my god.
One of the few good things about working downtown.
I went to Prime Rib Place in San Francisco that has like only Prime Rib.
Never been
like,
to San Francisco.
I have twice. Right now. I'm there right now.
Prime Rib, but it's pretty much just that kind of stuff, so I imagine they're probably on the same.
It's so good.
Yeah.
Tankerville is at 34 WC.
Oh, you ever been?
Polo has never been to San Francisco.
Oh.
He's been to the Tiger gas station in Louisiana. He didn't like meeting the tiger.
Aww.
All right.
Hello.
Lauren Jarrett, maitre d' of the Tankerville Club, condescends after a not-so-small gratuity to speak with us. What is it that you wish to know? Do you recall if Roland Jacquard had dinner here on the 30th of May? Jarrett's nose rises higher into the air, yet he manages to continue looking down it at us. Sir Roland Jacquard had a reservation for 7:30 p.m. He arrived at 7:25 with Mrs. Kathleen Lindsay. I was able to seat them immediately at table 6, Mr. Jacquard's favorite table.
Wait, was this a different night?
So the 30th of May, and we're looking into...
It's currently the June 4th.
When was he...
And he died on the 3rd, right?
Last night.
Oh, no, 4th. So, okay. Early morning, June 4th.
This is a different day.
So this is 4 days ago? The night that Nathan Revell was shot.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
So he arrived at 7:25 with Mrs. Kathleen Lindsay. Was able to seat them immediately at table 6, Mr. Jacquard's favorite table. He ordered a bottle of Graud La Rose, 1876, a wine that shows the nonpareil beauty of the Bordeaux grape. For dinner, please, Mr. Jarrett, we're only interested in the time he arrived and the time he left. He left at midnight in the company of Mrs. Lindsay. So Jacquard's party consisted of only Mrs. Lindsay and himself. He was joined by another club member, Colonel Sebastian Moran, at 9:10. He joined them at Jacquard's table, had one drink with them, and left at 9:45. Was that the last time you saw Jacquard? No, the last time I saw Mr. Jacquard was June 1st. He was in the game room most of the afternoon and came into the dining room around 8:30. He had dinner alone and left at 9:30. Have you seen Colonel Moran since the night of May 30th? No, he has not been in. Times.
How detailed.
How detailed. Yeah, this guy knows his stuff.
What a pro.
Any info need to be...
We need a calendar.
I think the gimmick of this one is just, here's a bunch of details. Now, timeline it all and figure it out. Which, yeah.
I haven't been keeping track of dates.
We can do it.
Last night. My head hurts. So the night, the second time that he was, it was Jacquard that went in the second time. When was that? June.
Wait, the second time?
Did it say he came in again after May 30th?
He was in the game room, yes. Came into the dining room around 8:30. He had dinner alone and left at 9:30.
When was that?
That was June 1st.
June 1st.
The night of Charles Attard's murder.
And,
who was Kathleen Lindsay? Do we have a lead on that?
Someone connected to them by him, according to Langdale Pike.
Okay. Okay.
And so when he had, he had been at the card club and got the telegram, was that Moran or Jacquard?
Jacquard who got the telegram. Okay. He originally said, I'm going to skip my theater thing and stay. I can stay until 10, but he got a telegram. He's like, screw it, I'm out right now, even though he has a reputation for wanting to milk losers as thoroughly as possible.
Do you mind giving me the times and persons again?
Sure.
On the 30th, Jacquard and Lindsay.
On the 30th of May, Jacquard and Lindsay arrived at 7:25.
And left at midnight.
Left at midnight. Left at midnight with Mrs. Lindsay. He was joined by Moran at 9:10. And he took off at 9:45.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So maybe Lindsay has details of their conversation.
Maybe. Can you give me the June 1st information
June
as well?
June 1st.
I'm gonna try and timeline all this.
June 1st, he came into the dining room at 8:30. He had dinner alone and left at 9:30.
Is today the 4th?
Yes.
4th, yes.
On an unrelated, possibly, note, there are two other things I saw in the current paper that might be of interest. Shooting shirts. Lee and Sons are now prepared to offer their specialty sporting shirts, so strongly recommended by medicine doctors in the field. Material is soft as silk, harmless. Well, maybe not that one, but this one. Wesley Richards, gunsmith, largest selection of imported firearms.
Mm-hmm.
Wasn't that little pepper box a rare one from America?
Yeah,
I think so.
We've mm-hmm. got German guns and American
yeah,
guns.
Yeah, German and American.
Well, German gun, I mean, we
probably more common.
This guy, but this is especially, largest selection makes me think a weird one like the pepper box might have come mm-hmm. from there.
Makes
does happen a street, 31 Northwest.
Might be worth checking out.
Sporting shirts one.
Yeah, maybe not so much, but
maybe not so much. It does have an address though, 23 West Central.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like I got a lot of details about their clothing that maybe, I don't know.
There did, yeah, we did learn a lot about what the guys were wearing.
So, what leads do we have to follow up on? We've got the gun shop.
Yep.
We've got Lindsay. Are we still? This was the tinker.
Wait, one of the guys is a barrister somewhere. Mm-hmm. I feel like
we haven't figured out who that even was yet, unfortunately.
Well, visiting Lindsay.
Yeah, visiting their homes would probably figure it narrowly.
Wait.
We didn't go to Jardine's or Jardine's.
The name of the
something and Company.
Yeah, Lindsay and Company.
Lindsay.
That's the senior clerk.
That's the same Lindsay. Last name as Kathleen Lindsay.
Oh, okay.
That's true. Hmm.
Indeed. As tedious as it is, I'd like to look at the corner information when there's a second to detail some of this.
I don't remember like when any of these people.
Oh yeah, yeah. Do you have the number?
So the corridor is
38 EC.
Yes, 38 EC. Let's just go back over.
Okay, I'll try and grab times.
Yeah.
EC 38 EC. Let's see. Okay.
Hot Twitch content, writing down days and times.
Damn right. Okay, so the first one will be about Ravel.
Okay.
Death on 30th of May. Could you tell us the time of death? I would say between 9 and 10 p.m. on the 30th.
Okay.
It looks like all the time-specific stuff for him. Yeah. Unhealthy, bad lungs matter. The next victim, Cyril Maud. Let's see.
And I'm sorry, okay. Ravel was the one of the ones killed by a large caliber.
Killed by a French gun.
French gun was Leo, I thought.
Two gunshot wounds to the back. It was a large caliber gun fired at close range.
Probably of German make.
It was I think so. Mm. Yeah.
Wow.
Okay, so Cyril Maude came in only a few hours after that of Mr. Ravel's.
Okay.
He was the stabby guy.
And he had been dead no more than a few hours. I would place the time of death around at around midnight, no later than 1 a.m.
So between 12 and 1 on June 1st.
June 1st. So it is Cyril Maude, same night, right?
Basically, yeah.
It is the same night.
Yeah, same night. But...
Okay.
Thank you.
Charles Addard. His body arrived at 10 p.m. June 1st.
What time?
10 p.m. June 1st.
I think it was also a Big Bang.
Oh, yeah.
It was Vegeta.
Sorry, I was picturing a pistol, but this is like a full-on rifle here.
Oh, really? A Mauser?
The name calls to mind a rodent. Small size.
Well, that was a rifle competition you found that Moron took place in.
Oh, just so, yes.
Wait, so were Ravel and Otard both killed by the Mauser?
Just Ravel
I'm also
and,
getting pictures of the pistol,
and
though.
Addard, whoa, whoa. I believe. Maude was the sharp object, stabbed through the armpit. So Leo Shepard.
Oh, wait.
When was Otard killed?
Otard was brought in at 10 p.m.
10 p.m. Arrived at 10 p.m. June 1st. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the first result was for a rifle, actually. Although I'm not seeing T11 as the date.
They don't talk about when it could have died.
Okay. So 10 p.m.
10 p.m. June 1st.
Addard arrives.
Yes. Leo Shepard. Where was it? Time of death between 8 and 10.
June 1st?
I think this is the 3rd. Right? Because he says last evening here. So
yes.
This would be the 3rd. Yeah. And then Roland Jacquard was on the 4th, so.
So time of death between...
Time of death between 8 and 10. Let me see. I don't think it says when he got in.
Well,
but I guess
that's
what
not
matters.
What matters.
Yeah. And then Roland Jacquard. He arrived a little after 3 in the morning. Death between 1 and 2 a.m.
1 and 2. The morning of June 1st.
Not long after he had supped on pheasant. And pâté de foie gras.
I'm sorry, you said between 3 and 4 a.m.?
1 and 2 a.m.
1 and 2 a.m. Jacquard.
Jacquard. 1 and 2 a.m. on the 4th.
Well, if he's accustomed to dining until midnight, I could believe it.
So this is another basically back-to-back murder sequence, because 8 and 10 in the evening, and then the morning of early morning, so...
Right.
They seem a lot more spread out when you talk about 4 days, but they're kind of more bundled.
I'd be interested to try and figure out where he ate dinner June 3rd.
Fancy French place.
Yeah, because I remember it, that we had his stomach contents.
Yeah.
We're talking about Jacquard.
Right.
Yeah, we had his stomach contents.
Yeah.
Right, so where did he eat?
Yeah.
So
didn't this stuff at the place we were just at sound French?
Yeah, with Lindsay, right?
But they said that they hadn't seen him since June 1st.
Oh, that's right.
There are a surprisingly small number of restaurants here in London.
Are you gonna sound French?
There's one called Vegetarian Restaurant.
There was foie gras, I think, was one.
Yes, I know.
Pâté.
I was just saying that Vegetarian Restaurant is a funny restaurant.
Oh, I remember I saw that before right now.
Yeah.
I feel like that's what you got
what
to
if
do
we...
like, in Texas if you were open a vegetarian, but it's called Vegetarian.
What's BG?
Background.
No, actually, none of these stand out to me as French.
Well, he was wearing French clothing. Not necessarily French. Alright.
Perhaps Lindsay could tell us. Maybe he spent the evening with her.
Yeah, I think it's a good check.
The coin and.
Dentists.
Shepherd had the coin.
Then we could try going to, well... Yeah, try going to Lindsay and Co. Yeah.
The Inquisition.
Would you guys be interested in going to Jacquard's residence?
Maybe. I'd rather speak to Lindsay first, I think.
Sure.
She might be able to tell us either something about him or...
Kathleen Lindsay.
Kathleen, I think.
Yes, Kathleen Lindsay resides at 19 West Central.
That's all it says. Mrs. Lindsay's maid... It wasn't all that it said. I made that up. I'm sorry. I'll never lie to you guys again. Mrs. Lindsay's maid asks us to wait in the drawing room while she announces us. A few minutes later, a comely woman in her late 40s enters the room. She's dressed in a pale yellow summer dress, and her light blonde hair hangs loosely down to her shoulders. I am Mrs. Lindsay. Please be seated. What can I do for you? We introduce ourselves and explain the reason for our visit. Yes, I have heard of the murders in the newspapers, but I don't know how I can be of help to you. We believe you knew at least one of the victims, is that right? I knew three of them. Charles Addard was my solicitor, Roland Jacquard, a friend, and Nathan Revel, who worked for my late husband's firm. For the life of me, I can't think why anyone would kill them. Do you think there's any connection in their murders? That's one of the things we're trying to find out. What do you think? As I just said, I can't think of any reason. Do you know if the victims knew each other? Well, Roland and Charles were friends. It was Roland who introduced me to Charles. I suppose Charles must have met Revel when he went to the firm to handle my business, but I'm not sure of that. Charles never mentioned Revel's name to me, and I can't remember. I don't think Roland knew Revel. How long had you known the victims? Well, I can't really say that I knew Revel. He worked for my husband, but I never saw him socially, of course. I have known Roland for about 10 years. Roland was a friend of my husband's. They played whist together, and we saw Roland socially quite often. Do you play whist, Ms. Lindsay? Oh, no, I don't. I hate the game. How long have you known Mr. Addard? About 10 years. Roland introduced me to him when I mentioned that I needed a solicitor to handle my business affairs. Did he do a good job? Yes, I was very pleased with him. I don't get along very well with Neil Patterson, my husband's partner, so it was much easier for me to have Mr. Attler deal with him. Do you mind if I ask you what the problem is with Mr. Patterson? No, I guess not. John, my husband, was in ill health during the last few years of his life. He died 4 years ago. As his illness got progressively worse, he needed more help with his business, and for that reason, he brought Neil into the firm as a partner. Neil was a hard-working, ambitious young man who at first was very appreciative of the opportunity that John had given him. But as my husband's health worsened and Neil took over more and more of the workload, he demanded a larger and larger share of the business. John had no choice but to give in. And then, when John was hospitalized 6 months before his death, Neil demanded control of the firm. He wanted to bring in Mainhart as a partner and take control. I begged Neil to wait until John was stronger before discussing business with him, but he wouldn't wait. He told John that if he didn't get what he wanted, he would leave the firm and start his own firm, taking most of John's client with him. John gave in. He had no choice. John was left with only 30% of the business. I think that was what called the... I think that it was the whole dishevelment that caused John's death. The worry, the uncertainty. He just wasn't strong enough to deal with it.
Hmm.
So, wasn't one of our victims in poor health?
That was Revel.
Yeah.
52, bad heart, bad lungs.
Not unusual for 52 back in that era, probably.
Yeah.
So
it's not unusual for me in this era.
So who had the message for Patterson?
Revel, right?
Okay, and Revel was working at the firm, so yeah, that makes sense. And it said Patterson, if you're reading this, I'm dead.
It makes you know, Patterson someone to talk to, though.
Oh, definitely.
Shout up the list.
Yes, Revel. Patterson, by the time you get this letter, I will be dead. The monies I took are in my room. I was in trouble and had choice. Now I'm taking the only way out, and I hope that you will...
yeah, exactly.
And Revel is, of course, one of the ones killed with a big gun and a Roman coin.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So he messed around with Moriarty and got screwed, is what it sounds like. Moriarty may not know about this other dude.
Difficult to say. Seems like Patterson might be a good lead. We've got two things pointing to him now.
Oh, yes. Now we know which part Patterson.
Patterson, let's have a look.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What do we got? Patterson.
Not the inspector.
Yes.
Yes, Neil Patterson at 69 East Central.
Oh, hey, it's me.
Yes. Our nicest address yet.
69
East Central.
EC.
Not to be confused with OC.
Do you often confuse the two? Oh!
I'm afraid this is a non-one. Mr. Patterson's majordomo tells us that his employer is currently at his workplace.
No!
Alright. So Lindsay.
Well, wait, that would be Lindsay and Company, Lindsay, isn't it? Lindsay. Excellent. Well.
Yeah, but. Yeah.
Grumbles. Wish we knew what time of day it was.
Yeah.
Why did you wake me up? It's 3 p.m., sir.
17 Northwest.
It did seem like it was the morning when we talked to Boxing Man. 17 Northwest?
Or you just had a late night since you. Yeah, 17 Northwest.
Since he was punching so much.
Yeah. Busy punching.
It's often that I stay out punching. Mm-hmm. Like Beyonce.
Neil Satterson, head of the firm, consents to see us in his office. Are you from the police? He shouts before we were even through the door. Not directly. Inspector Gregson has asked our help, and we, at this point, I will welcome anyone's help. I can't figure out how he did it. And it might have been months or years before the loss would have been discovered. Mm. We're going to have to go through every account. I'm sorry, you have us at a disadvantage. It's Revel! When Inspector Lestrade came to me with the note found on Revel's body, I was expecting to find the petty cash short. Or maybe one or two of the bank notes taken from a safe. But this? What exactly is missing? I don't know exactly what is missing, and I won't know until I've gone through every one of our accounts. You see, we're an international investment firm. Most of our clients' business is done through negotiable securities and letters of credit. It is up to us to manage these funds. Trust and secrecy are the main components of our business. If word gets out of this, it's... Oh, damn. Patterson shoves himself away from his desk, walks to the sideboard, and pours himself a drink. My partner and I are the only ones who even know who our clients are. Revel would have had to request each security number from the right bank. So far, securities have been found missing from three banks. So he could not have had an accomplice inside the bank unless he had one in each of the three. How much is missing? A little over 6,000 pounds. Your partner is Lindsay? Mr. Lindsay founded the firm but died over 4 years ago. His wife, Kathleen, owns his shares, but does not actively participate in the business. My partner's name is Richard Mainbart.
Hart.
Hey, that's an H.
Mainhart?
Yes.
What does a B look like?
It's very small. Okay. Fuzzy.
experience them. Well, what does that have to do with anything? I would certainly appreciate any light you can shed upon this crime, but I really must get back to work. Good day. And that's a different address.
I think we better see.
Wow.
So almost certainly, Revel stole sensitive information.
Oh, yeah.
Are we going to go find out about Maynard?
He stole money. Because he said...
Yes.
The money's...
Stole sensitive information in order to get the money.
So from other banks, yeah.
Yes.
Did we have any other bank leads? Bank of England, somebody.
Was Revel the one who liked cards, or was that Attard?
Revel played cards.
Mm-hmm. Revel was not as good at it.
Yeah. So he liked playing cards, but actually wasn't as good, and may have played beyond his means.
Oh, most certainly.
Most certainly probably. Played beyond his means.
Yeah.
Yeah, he said I was in a bad spot.
He got like increasingly stressed and worried playing cards. Against a guy who everyone loves losing at cards to.
Yes. Actually, were there, not to keep going back to this, but were there dates and times in the Bagatelle Card Club visit that maybe we should piece together?
That's not a bad idea.
Yeah, I would love to. go back to that. 14 Northwest is the card club.
Do we actually speak with Moran? Or did they speak?
No, we haven't found him.
Okay, good.
No, he's in America.
He's on the continent, they said.
The continent of the moon. Where Moriarty's secret base of murder books is.
14. Wait. Oh, that's 13. Wait.
14 Northwest.
Oh, North. Exactly as planned.
Oh. You can play whisk polo. Your tail whisks a lot. You don't know what I'm talking about at all, do you?
Spend a lot of time at the bar, at the club. So the last time they saw him was the 29th.
You can find me at the club.
Last time they saw who?
Ravel. Last time I saw Ravel was the 29th. They played until midnight, didn't win a game at all. Ravel was upset.
That's Ravel and Jakard?
That's Ravel and whoever's talking, which is...
Adair, I think.
Adair.
We haven't yes. lost you yet.
He said, we
no,
played...
No, we spoke to him at the bar. Yeah,
oh, Adair is the one.
Yeah, he said, we played until midnight, didn't win a game all night.
Okay.
But Ravel seemed upset. Let's see... Last Thursday around midnight, Ravel came to the bar. Didn't he seem upset? Right, I remember. The next night, the night Ravel was murdered, had a drink with Moran. Said he was waiting for Ravel, and he never showed up. He waited in the round until 8, and then left. So Moran, on the 30th,
yep.
was there until 8, waiting for Ravel.
That's the same night that he visited... That's the same night that he...
Just making sure we're all in the same place.
Was that the restaurant?
Oh, yes.
Or... Yes. He,
yes.
So that's... he left the restaurant and then about an hour later went to the restaurant.
To the card club?
Go USA.
He left the card club and went to the restaurant.
Yes.
Oh, I got you. I got you. Yeah, right. And he said he told me to keep an eye out for Ravel and if he came in to tell him that he would be at the Tankerville.
Right.
And then we went there and he wasn't actually there. Or they didn't... Or was he there?
Was
no, he was.
He was there.
Yeah, that's what we were just saying.
That was when he got the telegram,
I need to look
right?
at this timeline. I'm really glad it ran
half an hour.
Yep.
Does it mention Moran getting a telegram here? Or is that mm-mm. someone else?
No. I think that was Jakard.
No. Yeah, that was Jakard.
Yeah.
Who was playing, and then he left. Okay, so let's see.
Okay.
So Jakard arrived yesterday, which would be the 3rd.
Mm-hmm.
He arrived shortly after 4:30. Right. And then, he had theater tickets for 8 o'clock.
So it's all in close range.
Continued to play and win at 8:30. You remember the time because he just looked at his watch.
I'm sorry, is this June 3rd?
3rd.
And we're talking about Jakard.
Jakard received a postal telegram at 8:30 p.m. on the 3rd. After reading it, he jumped from his chair, said, "I must go, unexpected business."
I should go.
We can use this.
Okay, and that looks like all the times in this
okay,
one.
Thank you.
Yes.
Given Moriarty's involvement and still missing some reason for why they would have been killed, you want to try the toy store?
Is there a reason we're not going to go see if we can find Richard Mainhart?
No, it's also...
Business partner?
Definitely also valid.
I think it's...
The only
potentially. What else to do with the business do we think we're missing?
With which business?
The Zine Company.
I mean, if...
So...
Ravel...
Yeah, we don't know who knew about Ravel taking the money, maybe? Or maybe it was
Or why he was killed over it. I mean, I could see that being a Moriarty scheme... that he was involved in, but why was he killed? What went wrong, or what did he do wrong that ended up getting him killed? And why did he write to Patterson about it if Patterson wasn't his...
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Yeah, and Patterson didn't know.
Yeah, either. Mainhart might be worth a try.
Yeah.
I think Moriarty contact might be a fishy lead, given his reluctance to get involved last time.
Yeah.
This one has Moriarty's fingerprints all over it.
It seems weird that they'd give you the lead and then yank it from you when it starts actually being useful, though. I mean, I whiffed last time. This one also seems like it's much more involved directly with Moriarty than the other one.
Also, last time Moriarty was bonus points.
Yeah.
Sure.
I'm okay with either one. Which one do you guys want to check out?
Mainhart.
Mainhart's good. I'll check.
Oh.
Let's see. Mainheart, Richard, 51 EC.
He is at work. No, I'm sorry. He's got to be at home if this guy is at work.
Or he's
only
dead.
One person is allowed to be at work.
Yep.
We find Richard Mainheart in his study, resting in his chair, his long legs stretched out in front of him, head resting in his hands. Our entrance rouses Mainheart out of his lassitude. Come in, take a seat. How can I help you? We are investigating a series of murders that have taken place over the last week. One of the victims, Nathan Revell, was an employee of yours, I believe. Yes, unfortunately. He managed to embezzle over 6,000 pounds of the firm's securities before his death. I have just spent the day at the Bank of England in Drummond's trying to determine the extent of our loss. It was so simple. Once he knew the accounts and their account numbers, it was only a matter of transferring the money into letters of credit or into any account he chose. How did he find out the account numbers? Well, that's the question. Neil Patterson and myself are the only ones who have access to that information. The only ones? Yes, of course. Miss Lindsay, as part owner of the firm, had access to the files, but she had all the dealings with the firm handled by her solicitor, Mr. Aberrant. I only met him once. Aberrant? Do you mean Charles Addard? Yes, that's his name.
What?
What?
He was murdered 3 days ago. He was a barrister. He handled Miss Lindsay's business affairs? Yes, I missed the news of his death. I've been so concerned with this Revell affair that I've blocked out everything else. Do you see a connection? That's what you're trying to find out. Thank you, Mr. Mainheart.
Well, I'm glad we went there.
Yeah.
We already talked to Miss Lindsay, and she just seemed...
Yeah.
Addard, since he is also dead. Was he the one that died from a stabby?
No.
Bullets.
Big ones? Yeah.
Yes, he was the one killed in the same manner as Revell.
Yep.
Okay, well, those two have definitely got a much stronger connection now. They were also both coined, if I remember.
Yes.
Addard was not coined.
Oh, that's right. That was
Shepard.
Leo Strongman.
Shepard was coined.
So killed with the same gun, but only one of them marked.
Right.
Interesting.
Can we investigate their homes?
Sure.
So, Leo Shepard's a shady dude.
Yeah.
He was ordered to kill Nathan Revell because he did this stuff. And then maybe after Charles Addard.
We're still missing that, though. Like,
That was a wild theory I was throwing out.
No, that's true.
Like, if we're suspecting that he was deep in debt, like, Moriarty doesn't seem like the kind of guy that would just kill a guy just to grab a bunch of money. He's probably got tons of money already.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't know.
He does really like
money
schemes that get more money.
That's true, and 6,000 is a lot of money.
I feel that we could get some clues from either going to poke around Revell's place or Addard's.
He said the money's there, so.
Wait, well, one question: the theory you had wasn't so crazy, if I remember right. Because didn't Addard own a small gun of the type that might have been used to shoot Leo
before
he was killed?
Yeah, I believe
the one part that makes it not crazy.
Yeah.
It matches the order they were killed in.
And most importantly, Shepard was killed with a coin, which would seem, you know. So
he went off script and killed Addard for some reason.
There revenge for getting shot, presumably.
No, Adder's the one that shot him.
Oh.
Adder's the one that had the American pepper box, which
was
not good for killing.
So maybe he shoots him in self-defense, but doesn't kill him.
Yeah. Addard was killed
2 days later.
No, Addard was killed 2 days before Shepard.
Right.
Yes.
So what we're suggesting is that Shepard kills Revell and gets in a tussle with Addard, who shoots him. Then the next day, Shepard comes back and kills Addard in revenge for having been shot with the gun. And then a couple of days later, he is in turn killed by Moriarty. Or an agent of Moriarty for having executed a murder off script.
It's reasonable so far. We can hang on to it until something.
Fieldy, where should we go? Addard's place? Revell's?
Let's go to Revell.
Okay. Revell lives at London, England.
Do we know anything about Cyril Maude?
That's the one that we know like the least about.
Well, we haven't
he
been
was.
To his
yes,
yet,
true.
So.
We haven't really investigated.
He has been killed by something sharp. That is all.
Large
that I know
sharp
about
object.
Him.
44 WC.
Yeah. feels like the
44.
They're sifting into three groups. The three who are killed by guns, the knife guy, and the guy that we feel like we
right.
Solve.
Yeah.
44 WC.
Oh, am I reading? I'm sorry.
Hello.
We talked to Lindsay, right? And she didn't have any information about what...
Well, she told us about how the people were connected.
Yeah.
But she didn't really seem suspicious in and of herself.
But she was the one that had dinner with Jacquard, right? And then Moran showed up?
Yes. That...
And she didn't mention anything about Moran. Nope.
May have just thought of him as a friend of Jacquard, not someone she knew.
The landlady shows us into the rooms of the late Nathan Ravel. He was a quiet man, kept to himself. He lived here for 10 years, but I didn't know him well. He did drop down to play a hand of whist with me and some of the other boarders now and then. He loved the game. Ravel's rooms are neat and orderly. A check of his dresser and wardrobe shows his clothes to be neatly hung and stored. The only other personal effects that are visible are a few books and some toilet articles. Have any of Ravel's belongings been removed from these rooms? No, he paid his rent through this month, and I haven't wanted to remove them. The authorities are looking for his relatives, but it looks as if he had none. Did he have any friends? Not that I know of. He was out most evenings playing cards, and of course, he worked during the days. He always paid his rent on time and never caused any trouble. I still can't believe that he is gone. I don't know what the world is coming to when someone as unassuming as Mr. Ravel can't walk the streets without being murdered. As we look around the room, Mrs. Erlanger makes her own inspection, dusting here, straightening there. As she is straightening the window curtain, she says, more to herself than to us, I have to get this fixed. Pardon me. I was just talking to myself. I found this window broken, and I have to get it fixed. I guess Mr. Ravel must have broken it when he was trying to close the window. It would stick from time to time. When was it broken? I don't know. I found it that way when I showed the room to the police the day after the murder. They wouldn't let me clean up the broken glass until after they'd inspected the room. I still don't believe I got it all up. Have you seen all you want to? I have some work to do. Yes, we're done. Thank you.
So Adderd steals the money? And Shepard knows this and goes to kill Adderd for it.
Maybe so.
Because Adderd knows he gave him that account info.
But, I mean,
but I don't get why there would be the coin, though.
Shepard has to be involved, but yet if he did that, Moriarty either would have probably ordered that if that was the case, or he wouldn't have been upset about it. It definitely feels like Shepard screwed up.
Now, did it say Leo Shepard, like, had a coin placed on him? Because, like, presumably he could have had it in his pocket to place on somebody else, right? I don't know.
That's a good point.
Possible.
That's a very good point.
But
do we want to check Charles Adderd's rooms?
I would love to.
Yeah, you definitely want more on him.
12 WC.
That's you.
Sorry, 12 WC?
He's kind of on the list at this point.
Oh, yeah.
Does Leo Shepard even show up, or is that anyways? What do you think?
Leo
Shepard's on here.
All right. As our four-wheeler pulls to a stop in front of Charles Adderd's townhouse, we see a woman leaving by the front door. She's carrying a box, which she sets down as she clears the doorway. She turns, pulls the door shut, and locks it with a key from the pocket of her summer coat. After the door is secured to her satisfaction, she picks up the box and starts down the path towards us. Wiggins, the first one out of our four-wheeler, approaches the woman.
Excuse me, ma'am, could I have a word with you? I'm sorry, I'm in a hurry. It will only take a moment. We are investigating the murder of Charles Adderd.
The woman stops and looks at Wiggins. She is 40-ish, tall with raven black hair and pleasant features.
Charles was my brother. I am Jeanette Rooker. Can you tell me why Charles was murdered?
That's one of the things we're trying to find out. Do you have any ideas?
No, Charles and I were not very close. After my marriage, we saw very little of each other.
Is there anyone in the house?
No, Charles was a bachelor and lived alone.
May I ask what you were doing here?
I suppose so. About 2 years ago, Charles gave me instructions that upon his death, I was to collect this box and hold it until it was called for.
By whom?
I don't know. Charles said they would have a letter from him. Whoever showed it to me was to receive the box. That's all I know.
So you don't know what's in the box?
No.
Could we give you a ride to your house?
That would be nice. I was going to call a handsome.
Mrs. Rooker climbs into our carnage. Carnage! Setting her brother's box on the floor.
We all get on top of good old Cletus Cassidy.
My colleagues, Wiggins introduces us. Where to?
46 Tavistock Place, she tells the driver.
Would you mind if we looked into the box? Asks Wiggins once we are underway.
I don't think Charles would... It might help us find his murderer. I don't know. Oh, if it will help, go ahead.
Wiggins reaches down and opens the metal box and its contents to our inspection. The contents consist of a stack of files, which Wiggins removes and starts sifting through.
I can't make much out of these. They look like financial records. Bank deposits, stock records, money transfers. There are some notes, but they seem to be written in some type of code.
Here's a file labeled Carrington & Co. with a stack of what look like import documents. One labeled Lindsay & Co. has a list of negotiable securities and bonds. All the files seem similar in nature. It will take someone with more knowledge of finance than I have to make head or tails of these.
Here's my house. I will take the box now, says Mrs. Rooker as we turn into Tavistock Place and come to a stop at number 46.
Wiggins puts the papers back in the box and hands it to Mrs. Rooker. As Wiggins helps her out of the carriage, he says,
I wish you would take these papers to Scotland Yard and see what they can make of them.
I'm sorry. I have to do what my brother requested. Thank you for the ride.
Wiggins watches Mrs. Rooker walk up the path leading to her house. He turns to Simpson and says,
Wait here a while and see if anyone comes to pick up the box. If they do, follow them and let Holmes know where they go.
Can we visit her house for more information?
I was wondering that,
but
I
doubt it. What's her address?
It was 46.
But it didn't give an actual...
Tavistock Place, yeah.
But it gave us her name.
Yeah.
Rooker.
Jeanette Rooker, 46 WC. we gotta follow up, right?
Leave me alone, you
vagabond. Yeah, exactly.
Oh my goodness.
What?
We find Simpson sitting dejectedly in front of Mrs. Rooker's house. Has anything happened, Simpson?
Oh.
Asks Wiggins as we get out of our four-wheeler.
Well, yes, I guess. What happened?
I waited, like you said. About 2 hours after you left, a man arrived. He went into Mrs. Rooker's house, was in there about 15 minutes, and came out carrying the box. He got into a hansom. You followed him, I hope. Well, I tried. He got into the hansom, and as it started off, I ran after it. I was able to catch up with it, and it turned onto Woburn Place. Traffic was heavy, and I was able to keep the hansom in sight until it reached its destination, which was 33 Great Wild Street. Great Wild Street, good God. Elf Town. And that's where he got out? No, a woman got out. As soon as she got out of the hansom, it took off again and went to the Grand Hotel, but no one got out. I ran up to the carriage and looked in. Empty. He could not have gotten out without my seeing him. I don't understand what happened. Are you sure you didn't get the hansom mixed up with another one along the way? No, I'm sure it was the same one. I didn't know what to do, so I came back here to see if he might return. I think I'll have a talk with Mr. Rooker. Wait for me, says Wiggins as he starts up the path to Mrs. Rooker's house. 10 minutes later, Wiggins is back and tells us what he learned from Jeanette Rooker. She said a man arrived with a letter written by her late brother, Charles Addard. The letter requested that she turn over Addard's strongbox to its bearer. She did. He gave his name as Sebastian Moran.
Are we gonna go to 33 Great Wild Street?
Most certainly.
Gracious me. So what? Wait. Do we have an idea of how he disappeared from the carriage?
I have no idea.
Disguise.
Mystery.
I was thinking of the women's clothing.
Oh, maybe
so. He's already dead, right?
So which one?
33 WC. We're hot on the trail.
Yeah, somebody had to be driving it.
Like somebody still had to be driving it for it to go to the hotel, right? And then nobody was in there. Nobody got out.
Okay, 33 WC?
Yes.
Okay. We knock on the locked door of a Carrington and Company we knock on the locked door of Carrington and Company, and it is soon opened by a mountain of a man whose large frame blocks the doorway.
Oh, a mountebank.
Yeah, what you want? we were wondering if you could give us some information.
What do you know about mountains?
Yes.
Oh my god.
I'll give you some information. Get out of here. We ain't open to the public, understand? We would like to speak to the person in charge. Hey, mate! Yells the mountain into the dark room that he guards. These guys want to talk to the person in charge. In response to this information, three more men join him at the door. We're in charge, and we don't want to talk to nobody. With these words, the door slams in our faces.
What?
That's nuts!
What the fuck is going on?
What is Carrington and Company, and how did we accidentally wind up there?
Carrington and Company
was one before. It was one of the other places the notes said, yeah.
But what is it?
Good question.
Oh yeah, it was a place listed.
It probably
was,
a bank, right? Yeah. Maybe, well, actually...
It was in Eddard's papers in the box. Mm-hmm.
The probably another financial...
He had financial stuffs on them.
Mm-hmm.
A front? At this point?
Maybe, I don't know.
Interesting.
Haystack Calhoun was a mountain of a man. With a rolling DDT.
Oh, man. Things that only we will understand. Oh, it's a jeweler. Interesting.
Oh.
Yeah.
A jeweler. With those dudes.
Yeah. Look, they can be. They can have delicate hands.
I mean, where... Where do you mine jewels? In the mountains.
What if we checked out the Grand Hotel?
I can go for that.
22 WC. Maybe every location is connected to a place with the same digits.
22 WC?
Yeah.
Oh.
Double checking. Yep.
Where did the person go?
Oh, man. I think they went into the Man Mountain Cave.
Okay.
Forky Shell, Toy Store.
Toy Store.
Really, Toy Store interested.
What's Toy Store?
The Toy Store is, of course, at.
What's the Toy Store?
Moriarty related coded messages from our whole.
Oh, I see.
18 Northwest.
18 Northwest.
Where we can talk to Fred Porlock, member of the Criminal Underground, leaves coded information on the activities of Moriarty at the Parsons & Son toy shop, not Parsons & Company.
Ooh. Sam Parsons places a large box on the counter. Here's your latest gift from Fred Porlock. He opens the box and pulls out a large marionette. It represents an army colonel. At the end of each of its hands hang two smaller puppets, a lawyer and a sailor armed with a pistol.
That's blatant.
It's very blatant, but that's actually not bad.
It's not.
So sergeant, right?
I mean, heck, that even confirms that our sailor dude probably was the pistol dude.
Right.
And also says the lawyer, yep. So...
That would be Addard.
Addard. So Addard and Leo were...
They were
both working with him, which would explain why he got pissed if... The
lawyer
got killed.
That adds up. That's the...
One hand literally punched the other.
We should have figured that out before, because that's what Holmes pointed us to. The associates fighting with one another. That's what Moriarty would frown upon.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Dazzling.
Still don't know what went wrong with Ravel that made the problem initially begin.
I think he was just bad at gambling and got some money from...
wait a minute. I think I get where you're going. So there was a scheme Moriarty was working on that involved these guys. Ravel lost some money and endangered the scheme by doing more petty stuff with it potentially.
Where did we go and what did we learn?
Got some ill-gotten money.
We went to the toy shop.
Yes.
The toy shop?
Yes.
Yep. We got a box containing a puppet of an army colonel that had two puppets attached to its two hands, one of a sailor with a gun, one of a lawyer.
What does a lawyer puppet look like?
Why did we go to a toy shop?
That's the coded messages with Moriarty's dealings.
Was there something between the toy shop and going to...
We tried to go to the Grand Hotel, but we didn't find anything.
Do we know what the location was for the toy shop? Well, I guess it doesn't matter.
What led you guys to go to the toy shop?
Because it's Moriarty connected.
It's the Moriarty coded information.
It's
drop.
The back of the book Moriarty stuff.
Okay. Yeah.
So it's that one place we got the miniature safe.
Is
which I guess raises the question of...
And there were two smaller puppets hanging from each hand. One was a sailor dude, which is Leo Shepard, and the other one was a lawyer, which is Charles Adder.
Which one?
Leo, because we know nothing about him except, you know... Like,
so that says
he was
that
a big guy
Leo and Charles were together. And then so Leo got killed
because
for killing Charles.
Because I guess he does have the gun on the thing, so he probably was. I still think
Shepard
it's interesting that Moron was like a good
guy. They were working together.
Of course, he may have been the one who shot. Oh! He was probably the
and
one.
Who shot
Moron
who?
Probably shot Shepard.
Who shot who?
Because he's freaking pinpoint accurate.
These two are underneath Moron.
The
guy we can't find yet. And.
Or, I mean, if he was backstabbing someone.
They were tasked to kill Nathan
Ravel.
Possibly for the money or for whatever he's been doing.
Yeah.
And then apparently. I guess it was probably for the money, right? And then maybe Leo had...
With a steel chair.
Leo killed Adderd so he could get the money.
Maybe. He's moving around the desk side.
So the window
I'd
was
like
broken
in
to Ravel's place.
What they're about to see.
We sound so crazy to everyone else. Do we want to check out Shepard's house?
Possibly.
We don't know a whole lot about... Man number three yet. Cyril Maud.
I almost want to continue to lead him aside for a while unless he loops into this one, because I feel like at this point with this
can be
being
something.
This far into this one about hitting him, he's probably unrelated and I don't want to muddle the two threads.
I don't know, these could all be red herrings.
Could be.
Okay, well, where shall we go next then?
I was actually thinking, someone had to go by the banks to commit this particular type of fraud, right?
Yes, that's so.
My very tentative loose theory is that Adderd was the one who was actually supposed to do the work, because there was no puppet of him involved in this. Rebel was a minor figure in this.
Well, he'd be the one that would know the right questions to ask, too. In which case, we could go to the Bank of England or to Drummond's.
Yeah, I'd like to see what happened in both of those.
I think Bank of England's good, because we had actual
notes. We had that mentioned before, too.
Sure. 23 WC.
Yeah.
Hopefully there's not also Mountains of
oh
Men there.
Oh my!
Yes.
Ravel may have actually taken money.
That's what I'm thinking, yeah.
He thought he was taking money and he actually took something that had some of the notes in them.
They said that he took money.
Yeah.
Where the money is lost, at least.
Yeah, and he had the money in his place, and his window was broken, so somebody came and got it.
Yeah.
There is no 23 WC, is that what you said?
Bank of England.
23
EC.
EC.
Oh,
EC.
Yeah.
EC.
Yeah, I think it was... Yeah, but I'm wondering why Ravel was killed is because he wound up basically blowing this scheme. May have just actually tried to steal money from work to cover his gambling debts.
Mm-hmm. That's
and
what
then,
I thought.
And then send in a note and be like, "Oh, I'm so sorry," which caused the people to check.
Which
blew their cover, which is why they were like, "Ooh, this guy. We gotta get this guy. He ruined everything."
That would make sense. Yeah, he got into gambling trouble, decided to try embezzling. That exposes the whole thing. Moriarty's furious, or rather, the colonel, who may be Moriarty at this point, is furious. They got out of the carriage as a woman. Master of disguise, Moriarty.
Right. Moriarty is not a master of disguise.
I thought he was.
That's Sherlock.
But Moron is not.
I think both were, but never mind. I haven't finished reading the books yet.
Oh, sorry.
Bank of England?
Yep, we're here.
All right.
Mr. Kimball sits behind his large desk as we enter his office. He half raises his frame, but the effort seems too great, and he settles back down in his large leather chair. Good to see you again, he says in greeting and directs us to take the empty chairs in front of his desk. What can I do for you today?
15 chairs.
We have a list of people we would like you to check out for us. We would appreciate any information you could give us on their financial background. You know that this is highly irregular. We cannot give out this information to just anyone.
But we are the irregulars.
Mr. Holmes has been of great help to us in the past, and I will do everything I can to help as long as it does not violate our clients' confidences. Does this investigation have anything to do with the Revell death and the possible problems in the Lindsay and Company accounts? It may have. Then I would be glad to give you any assistance that I can. I have just had a long conversation with Mr. Richard Mainhart of Lindsay and Company, and he intimated that there might be some irregularities on the bank's part, so I will give you all the help I can to clear up this matter. Thank you, here's our list. Of course, we will keep you informed of anything we find out. Wait a moment and I will see what I can find. Kimball forces his large body from his chair and leaves the office. After some 10 or 15 minutes, he returns with a stack of folders and lowers himself back into the chair. Here's what I was able to find. He lays the folders down on the desk along with our list. First, Nathan Revell. He had an account with us. We handled the sale of his mother's property after she died 3 years ago. That left him a nice little sum, which he added to from time to time. Then, starting about a month ago, his balance started to drop. Here, take a look at his ledger. It shows between March 31st and May 10th his accounts dwindling.
How badly do they?
It goes from a balance of 3,467 currencies to 42.
He bankrupted himself literally. Yes.
We've all been there.
Active month for Mr. Revell. Do you have any idea what he used his money for? No, not yet. Nothing on Cyril Maud or Leo Shepard. Charles Attard has had an account with us for years. As you know, he was one of the top paid barristers in London, and his bank account attested to the fact. Both he and Roland Jacquard tended to keep large balances in their accounts. I do hope you will solve this case quickly and clear the bank of any hint of carelessness. If you guys would like to see his bank info.
Didn't seem very...
Just a regular decline.
Yeah. Seems...
yeah.
It could just be his gambling problem.
It's worse and worse and worse.
The only time it stops is when he's literally out of money.
Yeah.
Although it seems to stop well before the murders.
Well, he ran out of money.
Yeah, but he was still playing cards.
Indeed.
Indeed. Playing cards for peace.
Maybe he had borrowed money from a criminal organization and was on the hook to pay it back.
Maybe.
Or he just stole it from...
I've discovered something shocking. If you take the name of our erstwhile antagonist and rearrange it, you of course get...
I can't believe you. We're done here.
Hello, solve the mystery.
So we'll continue this one next week.
Guys, I'm Sherlock Holmes.
Oh, I pull up.
Hello.
Sorry if I almost crushed your head.
Hello.
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 I should not be a detective.
I should be a wizard.
I play one on TV.
We did it. The case is solved. Okay. Things are adding up.
Still would want to visit Drummond. That's useful. We like it.
I think that's very wise.
Yeah. I also want to see the Shepherd's house.
It's probably. It feels like a pretty strong case, though.
Yeah. 20.
Except for that one guy.
26.
Well, no, we haven't looked at that dude at all.
26.
26 WC.
We may just have to go to his house.
Yeah, I thought that's all we can do with him.
We can investigate the shipping company.
James Long, president of Drummond's Bank, gives us the following information. On May 6th, Mr. Revell opened an account with a £500 bank draft drawn on the Bank of England.
Over the last month, approximately 6,000 pounds in various letters of credit were deposited into that account. On May 30th, Mr. Ravel withdrew the letters of credit he had on deposit and closed his account.
Interesting.
So he was suddenly getting money again about the same time his other account ran out from letters of credit.
Yes.
Yeah, I think I'm kind of consolidating on the he screwed up the scheme by interfering with it, got killed for that. But then the question becomes why? I mean, I guess Adder took a shot at Shepard. Why though? I mean, I could buy Shepard killing him because Adder died, but why did Adder shoot him?
We know somebody broke into Ravel's place. I don't know. I
can buy that as Shepard easily enough.
I like thinking that maybe he, because he said that he had his money in his place. So.
And whoever killed him would have seen that note, because that note, yeah.
Why did they leave the note if they saw it?
Oh. So maybe that's a good point. No,
they were just both like informed, and they're like, "You need to go get that money." So they knew, and then Shepard knew that Etard had like taken the money or something like that.
It's possible the left hand literally did not know what the right hand was doing.
It's possible.
It's possible. Of note, Shepard is the, you know, mid-30s, the more athletic type to go breaking in windows potentially.
He's the criminal type anyway.
Yeah.
Definitely.
And Adder's 52.
I'm repeating what was in one of the evidence files.
Yes. Of low character.
A bad character associated with other of similar character.
A badness.
So he's a renegade Shepard.
Yes. shall we investigate Shepard's place? Maybe we can get some clue as to his relationship to all this. That is at 25 southeast.
Southwest?
East.
Southeast.
There's a southeast.
Did I say southeast?
I think you said southeast.
I hope so.
Southeast.
Okay.
Ah. There's a southeast. Shepard. Faye Shepard greets us at the door. She is a big woman with a voice to match.
Nice.
How many times do I have to tell you? Leo ain't dead!
That little runt of a police inspector scared me to death coming here and telling me my son was dead. Drags me down to Bart's to look at this big ugly guy. Scared me to death, he did. My son's at sea, has been for 4 weeks. That outburst over, she slams the door in our faces.
What the damn hell?
Leo Shepard's an alias.
Yes.
For Charles Addard.
Oh,
no.
What?
Well, wait, how did they identify him as Leo Shepard at the morgue then?
Did he have a
He had a note on him, didn't he?
Yeah, he had stuff on him.
Let's double check that.
Let's see. Shortly after 11 o'clock last night, another body was found floating. Has been identified by the Siemens papers found on his person as Leo Shepard.
Interesting.
What the hell is he doing with Siemens papers?
Didn't say something about Jardines?
Yes, we could speak to them.
Might clear the matter up.
Oh my god.
Why don't you take this one as well, okay. Lobos? That is, of course, we should have it memorized by now. The location is under J.
<laughs> 15 EC. In the offices of Jardine, we easily find information on Leo Shepard. Leo Shepard has been in our employ for many years. He's a good worker and an excellent sailor. He's been on one of our ships since the month of February.
Okay.
So the criminal type isn't actually Leo Shepard.
And yet, the puppet was a sailor with a gun.
Someone who's worked, perhaps, to gather a reputation as Leo Shepard.
Indeed. I wonder if Porky Shinwell might know something.
Maybe so. Mm-hmm. Porky Shinwell.
Criminal activity here to...
52 EC.
There are big crimes happening.
The fact that both of our criminal contacts have Pork in the name makes me think of Mother 3.
Porky Shinwell is standing behind the bar as we enter the Raven and Rat.
We take up the empty end of the bar and wait for Porky to get down to us. He is soon placing a pint of bitters in front of each of us. What can I do for you, mates? Heard anything about the so-called Thames murders? A little.
Thames.
Timmy.
Little. Two of the victims were regulars here. Cyril Maud and Curtis Twiggs.
I'm sorry. Read that sentence.
Two of the victims were regulars here. Cyril Maud and Curtis Twiggs. Two birds of a feather they were. Twiggs? Yeah, Twiggs. The one the police identified as Leo Shepard. Twiggs and Maud were partners. Part of the Moriarty gang.
What?!
It's a hell of a clue for a back of the booker.
Talk was they were morons, strong-arm boys, enforcers. Twiggs was a shiv man.
Wait, you said morons? Mm-hmm. Morons? Oh mm-hmm. my god, he's got everything for us.
Yep. Twiggs was a shiv man. Maud, a barker's. Shiv? Barker's? Shiv is a knife. Barker, a pistol. They were a mean pair. Any word on why they were murdered? No, nothing. After Maud was murdered, the word went out that Moran wanted to find Twiggs. No reason was given. Moran doesn't have to give one. When was the last time you saw them? The night Maud was murdered. He and Twiggs were at their usual table in the corner drinking their dinner.
Wait, I'm sorry. So that was the night that Maud was murdered?
Mm-hmm.
So that was the night of the
31st 30th. Of May. 31st of May, right?
Is it 31st?
That's what I have here.
For Maud's death. Yeah, it's recorded as 531 here.
Okay.
I don't have a 31st.
I don't have one either. I'm so dumb.
I have it from, I think the beginning.
Okay, sorry.
So
at what time were they at?
So, he and Twiggs were at their usual
Maud
table.
Maud and Twiggs?
Yes.
Maud and Twiggs. He and Twiggs were at their usual table in the corner drinking their dinner. Around 8, Moran came in, talked to them for a few minutes, and left. They quickly drained their pints and left as well. Thanks, Porky. Anytime.
What time was that?
Eight.
Eight on the 31st.
So we've got a path for Moran now. He was at the Ragatelle. He went to Porky's, spoke to Twiggs and Maud.
Wait.
Then went to dinner. Right?
Who?
Wait.
I thought Maud was killed on...
31st. No, Maud was killed...
Twiggs kills Maud.
Yes.
Because he's a shiv man.
I thought he was killed on the 30th, though.
Nope.
When was he killed?
He was killed between 12 and 1 on June 1st.
What?
Oh, we should double check that.
On the 31st. We assumed it was June 1st because we thought there was no 31st.
Sorry, the dates I'm going off are the dates that we got from the papers, so when the bodies were found and stuff. So
right.
There's potential crossover of days if they were murdered slightly before midnight.
What was Twiggs' name? Full name?
Did not say. Cyril. No, Curtis Twiggs.
Okay,
Curtis
he's Twiggs. In here.
Yeah. Okay, so sorry.
But he's Moran. Dead.
Well, yeah.
Twiggs, unless it is, and Maud at Porky's.
But we don't know anything about Maud and why Twiggs would kill him, huh?
Well, but so that's the night that Ravel was killed.
Maud killed Ravel.
It sounds like Maud and Twiggs. Or wait, Maud. Yes, Maud kills Ravel.
Right.
Twiggs kills Maud for some reason.
Unknown.
For the.
Wait, so Ravel was killed on the 31st as well?
I think we should absolutely double check that.
Yeah, I swear that we said.
I have him in the 30th. I'm pretty sure he was killed.
It's the same.
30th
night.
Late. Yeah. Late on the 30th, Maud early on the 31st. So 11 p.m. and 1 a.m. Not exact times, but
between
that close together.
I just wanted to make sure that they didn't say .
That's what I have written down.
Wait, no, this is important.
But the timeline kind of changes it up. Because
it does, it absolutely does.
Because of the when they actually died.
Because this is no longer June 1st. This is the 31st.
How was Edward killed again?
Shot twice with the large caliber.
But the gun dude is dead by then.
maybe that one.
Yeah, see, this is what I mean. There's a whole other day in the mix now, which means a lot of our dates might be screwing around.
Same type of gun. Not necessarily the same gun. They were very careful to underline that it was not the same gun necessarily.
And they said he was shot twice, somewhat unnecessarily. Yeah. So maybe it was...
It was not Ace Gunman.
Yeah.
It was another gunman.
He was just like...
Ugh. Junior gunman.
Yeah.
But he was panic.
That kind of calls the whole thing into question now, because then he kills Twigs. I mean, Moran's like the other person, but... I mean, does Shivman take his gun and then use it against the barrister? And if so, why?
I need a sharpened pencil. Okay. May 31.
Should we,
Yes.
For ease of conversation, should we now refer to Shepard as Twigs?
If we can remember, yes.
Okay. I crossed out all my references to him with Twigs.
Twigs.
He definitely is someone I want to go visit the home of. As his mod now that he has been officially involved in proceedings.
Now we know he's part of the Moriarty gang.
Do we think it's just a chain of, like, this guy's got the money and I want it, or something?
Maybe so. It could absolutely be that. Okay, hang on.
It could be. I mean, these guys are in Moriarty's gang. They know he doesn't take kindly to that sort of shenanigans.
Yeah, that's true.
And he's had a pretty good track record over the last 2 years of killing off people very quickly when they get out of line.
Yes.
With four people, especially after the first couple start dying.
Right.
Just chain.
You know, maybe we should stop messing with this.
Okay.
My current suspicions are Maud killed Rebel, Twix killed Maud, Oscar killed Jaggard, but we don't know who killed Adderd or Twix.
Oscar. Right. I'm just gonna reduce
Marco,
this
right?
to like.
Oh, Marco, sorry.
That's okay.
Marco!
So the dinner at Tankerville happened on the 30th. So at 7:30, Jaggard is there. And then at 9:10 through 9:45, Moran is there. And then at midnight, Jaggard leaves. Sorry, there's so much information. I don't want us to screw it up on a technicality. And then on June 1st, which is 2 days later, not the next day, he was in the game room most of the afternoon. Tanker. Card.
Jaggard rooms?
Yeah. Ate dinner there from 8:30 to 9:30. Then, where were we? Where is the Raven and Rat?
Raven and Rat is 52 EC.
52 EC.
Vroop, 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 vroop.
Yarr! So much information! Where's EC? There it is. 52? Okay. When was the last time you saw them? The night Maud was okay, so actually we want to backtrack to 22 something, right? Where's the coroner?
Criminologist is 22 Southwest.
Okay.
That's still on the first
night,
I believe. Oh. Wait, this is Murray. I want Meeks, the one that can tell us when they died.
Ah, sorry, that's 38 EC.
That would be a real bummer if We were right on the verge of finishing it, and then our dog ate the clues. Okay. Ravel was brought in around midnight of May 30th. So is that the start of May 30th? I guess it must be. Right? Or no, is it...
Midnight is such an annoying time.
The first victim, Nathan Ravel, was brought in around midnight. I often work a late shift and did the autopsy at that time.
Yeah, that was...
Yeah,
it's the night of the May 30th.
Okay.
So June 1st morning, right?
24 hours late for a flight that left Columbia at midnight. That sucked.
Yes. Yes.
Oh, yeah, but then you got engaged.
Yeah, that was good.
So
yeah.
That was,
I could have been engaged a day earlier.
You could have been. And then the chocolate would have melted. Okay, so near midnight, Ravel is killed. Oh, no, he says later here, between 9 and 10. I'm sorry. Okay.
Maud's killed between midnight and 1 a.m.
Right. On the 31st. That same night. So
yeah.
12 and 1 a.m. May 31st, mm-hmm. Maud is killed. Leo Shepherd...
Twigs,
thank you. Time of death between 8 and 10 last evening. So that's still June 3rd.
June 3rd, last evening.
Right.
Yes.
Twigs.
Yep.
Addard body arrived 10 p.m. June 1st. Mm-hmm. So that's not the same night as
right.
Ravel and Maud, like we previously believed, but it's a full day later. That, I think, is the important information that I figured we might be missing out on. Addard, dead, brought in at 10. Okay. All right, where do we want to go?
Did we want to go to Twigs' place?
Twigs' residence, yes, absolutely. Yes. Where is it?
Twigs.
Sorry about all that, I just...
No, that's
Five southeast.
Five southeast.
Uh-huh. Twigs' comic.
Good lord. Wai Fangong, landlord of the Celestial Garden Apartments, is a small, stout, round-faced man. His smiling face radiates the oriental optimism that allows him to give his dirty, ramshackle dwelling such an ethereal name. He not here. He go away, is Gong's response to our question about Curtis Twigs. Can we see his room? You want room? No, we want to see Twigs' room. Him no have room. Him go away. Give up room. 4 day ago. Do you know where he went? No, he leave bag with me. Be back for bag. No, no when. Can we see the bag? You pay, see bag? Wiggins takes a coin from his pocket and hands it to Gong. Gong waddles through the doorway and into his room. We follow. The room we enter looks something like something out of the Emperor's palace. It is immaculately clean. Silk paintings hang from the wall. Beautifully carved ebony furniture is tastefully arranged on a large brown rug with fire-breathing green dragon design. I get back. Gong goes over to one of the cabinets which line the right wall. Opening one of the doors, he removes a tattered black bag and brings it over to us. No take, no thing. Twig kill me. Bad man. We no take. We won't take anything. We just want to look. We open the bag and remove the following items. One gold watch with the initials CA engraved on the back. Several pieces of jewelry and rings. Four wallets with identification in the names of Charles Addard, Wilfred Roberts, Nathan Ravel, and Rory Winslow. And lastly, a 7-inch stiletto with a pearl handle. Wiggins replaces the items in the bag and hands it back to the landlord. Thank you, Mr. Gong.
Morning!
Yeah, I know.
Indeed.
So wait, he had Charles Addard's wallet?
Yes, yeah. Charles Addard's wallet and his watch.
A
bunch of jewelry and rings, Nathan Ravel's wallet, and two brand new names, Wilfred, W-I-L-F-R-I-D,
I-D.
Robarts, which is like Roberts, but with an A,
and then Rory Winslow.
But for him to have Adder's wallet, he either killed Adder or killed whoever killed Adder.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Right. So but crawling means he killed Adder. I think, yeah. Don't have another person.
Unless it was one of these new people.
But wait, Adder was killed with a gun.
Right.
But was he the one that killed with an unskilled hand?
Yes.
Yes.
So after Maud was dead.
Right.
Yeah, he took Maud's gun because he's like, Maud has a sweet gun. Because
he's like, I want to be both a knife and a bark man.
Or maybe right. I want to frame the guy I just killed for
this. Yes, war. So that Moriarty won't kill me.
Didn't work.
Turned him into a puppet.
Probably didn't work. He waited 2 days after you killed the other guy and didn't properly get rid of the
If body. Only he hadn't forgotten that May has a 31st. Crime doesn't pay.
It was very
to bad. Die.
Well, I suppose we should check out these other people.
I guess so. We've been everywhere else in town. Come on, let's
know.
Go.
I mean, well, okay, what are we missing? What do we need to learn?
What do we think happened start to finish? First, Ravel there was
steals,
nothing.
Ravel steals money.
Ravel steals the money.
Because he owes for gambling debts.
Right.
The owner of the gang.
Yes.
Some Maud.
Maud kills him.
Sorry.
And Twigs. Takes the money. Twigs wants money?
He does take.
That's the one thing I was really hoping that we would get from visiting his quarters. Some sort of a motive.
He may just, be into petty theft, ultimately, and saw this as a chance to do more of that.
Sure. I mean,
he has a bunch of jewelry.
If you were told, hey, this guy took our money, go kill him and get it back. And then you kill him and say, sorry, we couldn't find the money, but you have the money.
I thought they said that Twigs had been working for Moriarty for a long time, though. Wouldn't he be, sharper than that?
Why? I guess the question is, why did he turn on Maud?
Yeah.
Maybe Maud didn't want to go in on his scheme to steal the money.
Yeah. Yeah, probably. I guess if he wanted to just take it for himself.
What if we visited Maud's... This is the wrong book for me to go flipping through. What if we visited Maud's residence to see if we can get a line on him?
Maud was the one who killed Ravel. I mean, Twigs may not even have been involved.
Right. It's true.
But they work together.
Yeah,
they do work together. They do work together.
And, the
Shank... Is there a reason to send both of them to kill someone, especially a non-combatant? I don't know. Just thinking.
Sure.
Yes.
Maud, who it turns out does not have an E in his name, lives at 6 Southeast.
You're right.
Take it away.
I'll take a look. S to the E.
When it gets to the end and it says home, solve this case in 4 leaves, and pipe right out of his mouth and throw it at him.
What is
I think the last one was 7,
number?
Right?
Yeah, the last one was 7.
This is beefier,
I think.
You said 6.
6 Southeast.
Okay, this is a tiny one. Maud's room, if you can call it, if you can call a 6x8x8 foot space a room, contains only a bed and a sea chest. An inspection of the chest reveals some old clothes, a small metal box which contains 200 pounds in cash, a box of Mauser 11 millimeter shells, and a Webley revolver.
Webley revolver.
Interesting.
Webley.
So Maud definitely kills Ravel. Probably by himself.
Yeah. Interesting too, the puppet, remember, had a sailor with a gun. That was a sea chest, you said.
Yeah.
So Maud is our sailor with a gun, not... has nothing to do with Twigs. So Maud and Adderd are the ones who are the puppets of...
Of Moron. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So then is Twigs...
Both his puppets...
Even a Moriarty man?
But it is interesting that both of the puppets die right after each other, Maud and Adderd.
Yep.
Maybe... Okay. Something's starting to come together for me. So Twigs is just along for the ride with Maud, because they just roll together.
Yeah.
And they're going out doing dirt. Maud and the lawyer are both in on this broader scheme, and Maud knows why it is that he's going out to kill this man.
Right.
Twigs is just kind of, they're just...
I got nothing better.
Or alternately, they weren't even rolling, but Maud let slip what his job was tonight.
Maybe so.
So Maud goes out and kills first guy.
Ravel.
Twigs.
But he doesn't have the money. He left it in his room.
Right, right. But Twigs basically hears from Maud how much money is in play in this scheme between him, the lawyer, and Colonel.
Yes.
So Twigs basically decides he wants to just
the money.
Just to cash in. So he goes and shanks Maud and takes and basically takes everything that is on Ravel, then goes smash and grabs, and then knows from Maud who Maud's accomplice was, the lawyer.
Yes.
And goes out to stab
him. To dispatch him to make sure it doesn't get back to...
Or just to get the rest of, you know, the, like, to see if he can... Yeah, either to...
Probably tying up loose ends, I think.
Yeah, either to tie up loose ends.
So that no one knows that he tried to pull one over on Moriarty's gang.
Or he goes to the lawyer and tries to force him to surrender the banknotes, at which point the lawyer shoots him with the pepper box.
And then
he's like,
yeah.
No, and shoots him back.
Yeah.
The reason he didn't shank him is because they were at, like, gun range.
Okay.
And he shoots him, takes it in the shoulder, he shoots back twice.
And then Jacquard gets beaten up by a boyfriend.
Yes. The final piece is... With both of his subordinates eliminated, the colonel comes and with his expert marksmanship, plugs
Twigs
in the back.
Yes.
He's paralyzed, falls into the sea, and drowns.
Yes.
Twigs is part of this. So it doesn't hurt that Twigs is also a Moriarty enforcer, because that is what Porky said.
Yeah, he's
a Moriarty enforcer, but not in on this particular.
He's not one of the two puppets.
Yeah, okay.
He's neither pistol sailor nor is he lawyer.
So they kill Ravel,
even though he is
sailor
now.
He is the one that is disguised as a sailor.
True,
but he doesn't have a gun.
Until he does.
Hmm.
I mean.
I think we have the major strokes. What were you saying?
I was gonna say, so Ravel gets killed by Maud.
Mm-hmm.
Who goes and breaks into the place? Is it Maud to get the money back, or is it Twigs because he hears about the money being there in the first place?
I think that it must have.
I think it was probably Twigs just because Maud was stabbed so quickly there.
Wanted to see chest though. He could also be the sailor with the gun.
He could, yeah.
They could all be sailors.
Twigs is not a gunman. That was established, so
yeah.
I could see Maud being, especially with the sea chest reference.
Porlock, in theory, should know more about the case than we do. Yeah, about that kind of stuff more than we do. I would hope not.
Do we feel like, what do we feel like we still need before we try to solve this?
I wish I was a little more convinced on the middle part of it. I think we got the start and the end.
Well, we can look up the names. Wilfred Robbins.
Yeah, that's fair.
I think those are just people that he stole from, because he is greedy.
It
could establish that he is in some way greedy and very prone to making the sort of error of crossing the gang that he's been a part of for 10 years, even knowing, I'm sure, firsthand as an enforcer how deadly they are.
Yeah.
It's like, we already did put up this stuff. I've killed dozens of men at his order myself.
That's true.
He's going to turn on Moriarty. There needs to be a good reason for it, other than just I wanted some shinies.
Yeah.
I've been wearing my sweater inside out this whole time.
Oh, wow.
Do we want to go for them?
Sure.
Winslow first?
Winslow! Rory Winslow, 77 EC.
77. EC, huh? Rory Winslow greets us warmly when we return his wallet to him. It was a gift from my dead mother. It was very dear to me.
Well, there, we got some Paragon points.
So
perhaps the other.
The guy's not dead.
He's just a pickpocket also, I guess.
Yeah, so that...
I mean, I am.
I guess.
Oh, no.
Yeah, that
29
I actually...
Northwest.
Says
I don't, do we need to go to the other
I don't know, I mean...
I don't think so.
I'm kind of okay with thinking that, too. But what if it's like... And then
I would rather be thorough.
29 Northwest.
As usual, I'm more interested in finding out if we're.
I mean, I feel like what we wanted
correct.
To find out, what we wanted to find out was if he like makes those risky decisions like that. There's
One other thing we could do, because they've actually been mentioned a lot during these clues, we could check the central carriage stables movements of folks. Because I mean, there was a bit of that in this one.
I feel like we know well enough where people were.
Yeah.
At what time?
Maybe.
I'm fine with solving now, but I'm also okay with following up with solid leads that we think we might have.
I'm ready to solve.
The one back of the book one that we might want to look at now that we know what kind of a criminal element we're dealing with is the guy that deals with legal history.
Legal history. That would be Disraeli O'Brien. Mm-hmm. Do we want to check him out? 14 WC?
Sure.
Mm-hmm. 14 WC.
Because more than once we've seen that he has some really important information.
He tends to be on point. Okay, here we go. I could find a criminal record for only one of the names on the list of murder victims you gave me, says Disraeli O'Brien. That was Cyril Maud. He had a long record, which you probably found out of the yard. The only thing that looks strange is that within 2 years, he was arrested 3 times for violent crimes, and each time the cases were dismissed for lack of evidence. In each case, he had the same co-defendant, one Curtis Twiggs. Mm-hmm. So they did work together. If they were co-defendants, they were both accused.
Sure.
We could never find anything against Addard, however. The Brock case gave us a hint about his ties with the London underworld, but he was always clever enough to probably hide those ties. The murder's witness, William Lumpkin, who was kept in a secret place, disappeared. We suspected Addard, who occupied the same cabinet at the time, picked up the address and linked it to Moriarty's gang. With the absence of witness,
I don't know what we're talking about. It sounds like we've just discovered an
There's
entire
There's a William Lumpkin murder. Who was rooming with Addard?
Hold on, let's see. The Brock case gave us a hint about his ties, but he was always... Murders. Alright, so there was a witness apparently for this murder.
Oh, this is a different murder.
Yeah. Okay. Something to do with Brock.
Yeah, it was a murder that Cyril Maud and Curtis Twiggs were accused of, it sounds like. There was a witness, William Lumpkin, who was kept in a secret place and disappeared. The suspected actor, who occupied the same cabinet at the time, picked up the dress and leaked it to Moriarty's gang. With the absence of the witness, the presumed murderer, Adrian Toombs, was acquitted. Oh, wait, that was a different murder then. Well,
I hate the sentry.
It proves that the one guy was working with Moriarty's gang, but we kind of already gave him.
But they did establish they worked together,
right?
Oh yeah, yeah.
Like directly, they were working together. Even
more than it was like a concrete
murder buddies.
It was a concrete evidence.
Murder buddies.
Yeah.
Well, for me at least, I like knowing that it was actually routine for Maud and Twiggs to both go kill people together.
Yeah, I still thought that was evident from
the Porky Shinwell interview.
Yeah.
Hanging out together didn't necessarily jump to do the job together, especially when we're both professional killers and, can do the thing.
Right.
I have no objections to attempting to solve. I'm a little iffy on things, so I don't know of any way to get less iffy. So.
Same here. We've been at it for a while, and it's time to go ahead and
punch
it up.
There you go. I will.
The murders in or around the Thames.
Thames.
A
river that flows.
Good gravy.
Edge.
There are 12 questions for part one.
Well, there's a lot of info. So.
There is.
Holy shite.
Good gravy. Oh my god.
All right.
Right. What? What has happened?
Okay. Number one, who killed Nathan Revelle?
Maud. Cyril Maud?
Cyril Maud.
Cyril Maud.
Okay. Keep going.
Spectacular. Number two, why?
Because of,
Rebel took money.
Theft
and interference with a larger scheme.
I'm not convinced he was disrupting a scheme that Moriarty's gang was a part of.
Not convinced of that?
I mean,
I would say that.
Does Moriarty just go for money?
I think he might have borrowed from Moriarty.
Oh yeah, yeah, right, yeah,
okay. Yeah.
Well,
owed debts. To him?
I mean, we could softball it and just say it was for money.
Holmes
likes it when we softball.
I feel like it's specifically...
I don't know.
Yeah, we...
Patterson letter.
He said he was in a bad position.
Right.
He had to take the money. He had taken credits.
Well, that's what I said. That was addressed to Patterson.
I was in trouble and had no choice.
I guess just so an explanation.
That he was... Okay, so he was killed to prevent exposing the scheme. Yes, yeah. That makes sense. Okay.
So stole money and was killed to prevent that exposing the scheme.
Yes.
Money. He's now taking the only way out.
Alright.
Number three, who killed Cyril Maud?
Twigs.
Curtis Twigs.
Curtis Twigs.
Okay.
Number four, why?
Double
for the money?
Double crossings for, for mines.
For 8,000 pounds?
6,000.
6,000,
I thought.
Do we want to specifically say, I guess, for the money that Nathan supposedly had hidden?
That's what I thought. Mm-hmm. Why else would he have been double-crossed?
Okay.
This is the wrong paper.
Or just the money involved in the scheme.
I don't think he could have gotten to that, though.
Yeah, I guess.
He doesn't strike me as having the banking skills to be able to do anything with that, but the money Nathan said, hey, I've got it in my room.
But he then goes to try to get the rest of the bank scheme money, I think.
But he might not have known precisely what to do with it, just that it was valuable.
The only information he theoretically should have had was what was on the note.
No, I think he heard about what was up from Maud. That's why he goes after Adder.
Maybe, but would even Maud have known that? I mean, he was just an enforcer. He wasn't a critical part of the scheme. He was just
Other puppet. Like, he's working with the colonel.
He's the other puppet, but I don't know if I'd tell the other puppet if he didn't have a reason to know. Here's exactly how this giant bank scheme works.
This happened.
Unless we're completely incorrect.
I mean, we can keep it vague. That's, it's definitely for personal. You definitely
for personal gain. No question.
Okay.
Money.
Yes.
All
right.
Why was he killed? To derive some benefits.
Yes. Because it seemed like a good idea at the time.
Five. Who killed Charles Addard?
I think that was our Twigsman again.
Twigs. With Maud's weapon.
With Maud's gun.
Hopefully that's a separate question because I want to get different points for you.
Six. Why?
I think this was... I think there was an altercation.
Between two associates
for
possession of the money?
I think that maybe Twigs tried to...
muscle into the scheme?
Yeah. He wanted to, basically either A... like, double cross all the way up and get the money, or B, just get what Maud would have gotten.
Alright.
Yeah.
Well, which is it? Get in on the scheme or get what Maud would have gotten?
I don't know exactly how far he tried to go in there. It could be that he just knew that there's this huge amount of money in play, like, with all the securities and wanted,
He wanted in.
Okay. Yeah.
Maybe Adder just suspected Twigs for killing Maud, and he was like, "Did you do this?" And he's like,
"That is also possible."
Oh, that's a way better.
Yeah, I like that. Because he would have known, of course, who
his specialty.
Yeah, no, you're right. He probably could have come after him just for that. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And ratted him out to Moran.
Mm-hmm.
Number seven. Who is the person identified as Leo Shepard?
That's Twigs.
So if one of the answers is Leo Shepard killed whoever, then we know that's right.
Okay, number eight.
Number eight, who killed him? That is the person identified as Leo Shepard.
The colonel.
Colonel Sebastian Moran.
Sebastian Moran.
Otherwise known as Colonel Sanders.
That's not what he said.
That's correct.
Also known as Colonel Get a Brain Morans. Go USA.
Number nine, why?
Because he ruined the plan.
Screwed everything.
For betraying the gang.
Betraying the gang.
Yeah. In the name of Moriarty and the moon.
In the name of the moon.
He will punish you.
Number 10, what do we got?
Number 10, who killed Roland Jacquard?
Marco Escobedo.
Yes.
Marco
the Pug.
Pug.
Oh, what an adorable murder.
They were only partially deformed from inbreeding back then. Oh, here's an article about his fight.
Oh.
That's funny. Number 11, why?
Blue.
Love.
Over Leticia love Garcia.
In the name of Love and the Moon.
Yes.
Alright. Oh, caught in the act, we should say, maybe.
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Sure, caught
yeah.
in the act of amorous friendship.
High fiving.
Number 12. Were all the murders related?
Almost.
Not.
Almost.
4 out of 5.
Yep. Holmes likes it when we softball. Part 2. There are 4 questions here. These are all great. These are all fantastic. Number 1. What was the dog's name that traced Jacquard and Adderd's path?
What?
We never looked up the dog.
We didn't.
Nope. Next question.
You're putting Pullo, of course.
Hold on, Jacquard and Adderd's path.
Jacquard and Adderd's path.
It'll be right in our hearts.
Surely this was a bloodhound of some kind.
So the kind we read about in the paper and never did anything with.
We should have spoken to Elton Sherman. Mm-hmm. Number 2. Who killed Nikolai Polkrovsky?
Did you see
that was the husband of one of the amorous connections to Jacquard, remember? Langdale Pike told us that.
We did not investigate that one.
Well, no, why would we?
We were a little busy.
What's Langdale's address again?
Langdale is at 2 Southwest.
2 Southwest. Oh, and we can't forget Alexandra Pokrovsky. Last year, while her husband was in Russia, Roland and Alexander were the talk of the town. There was even talk of her leaving her husband for Roland. But that may have been past history by now. May have been, and now that Roland is dead. Poor Roland.
Her husband.
Wait, who was the person who was out of town?
Who killed Nikolai Polkrovsky?
I don't know, but who was the wife that he was with?
Alexandra.
What was her last name?
Polkrovsky.
Polkrovsky. Is there a Russian thing?
There's definitely a country.
Anarchist thing.
Oh.
The servants at the Russian social
group. That's not it. That's about it.
Well, this would have been a while ago.
Oh, no.
No, that's true.
Alright, I don't think we know this one.
No, yeah.
Number 3. Oh, we surely know this one. Why was the body of Reinhard Lutz found in a woman's dress? Because he was disguised as a woman. For Moriarty? To smuggle stuff into Carrington and Company. Sure.
Yeah.
But we saw that the lady. This was after
she was dead.
No, but maybe that's a common MO.
Right. I guess so.
Take mountains and disguise them as women and put them in handsome carriages.
I just noticed your shirt. It's wonderful.
Thank you. Look at
smuggler.
Me.
So Carrington and Company smuggler.
Yeah. Sure.
The one who's moving now.
Oh god, what is it?
Number 4. Who killed Lutz?
The fuck?
Diana. Diana. Diana.
Yes, hello.
Diana.
Uh-huh.
Who killed Lutz?
Moriarty.
Diana Fielding.
That's not my name. My mother named me Fieldy Field.
Oh. Bless her.
You just put Wilfred Robarts.
Shall we discover what Holmes figured out 8 hours ago?
Yes.
So no answer for 4 either?
No.
The moon.
Now that everyone is here, we can begin, says Holmes, who's been waiting for us for 8 hours. On the table is a worm unknown to science. That's not true. As we enter the rooms, joining Inspectors Lestrade and Gregson, a very interesting case with some twists and turns that I wasn't expecting. We'll start with the murder of the first victim, Nathan Revell. His story can be put together as follows. Revell, a hardworking clerk for most of his life, had one passion, whist. Whist is a pleasurable enough pastime, until one starts playing for money with the likes of Moran and Jacquard. By cheating Revell at the card table, Moran was able to force him to participate in his scheme to embezzle from Lindsay and Company. As you probably discovered, Charles Adderd was part of Moran's organization, and also Mrs. Lindsay's lawyer. As such, he had access to the firm's confidential records. Thus, Moran had all he needed for his embezzlement scheme, someone who had access to the firm's confidential accounts, Adderd, and an inside man to make use of that information, Revell. All in all, a good plan, except it developed a flaw, Revell.
As Ravel's suicide note indicated, he had a change of mind. He saw that embezzling would solve nothing. It would merely lead to new, insoluble problems. He saw only one way out, suicide. On the evening of May 30th, Ravel was to take the embezzled securities to Moran, who was waiting at the Bagatelle Club. While Moran was waiting, however, Ravel was writing a suicide note and leaving the securities in his room for Patterson to find. When Ravel didn't show with his rendezvous with Moran, Moran sent two of his henchmen, Maud and Twiggs, to find Ravel. We have no way of knowing what Maud's instructions were to his henchmen, but I think we can assume from the presence of the Roman coin found in Ravel's body, and similar coins in the bodies of victims we have come across, that they are ordered to murder Ravel as an example to the underworld of what happens to those who try to double-cross Moran. Maud, the gunman, shot Ravel, and then he and Twiggs dropped the body into the Thames. They returned to Ravel's room, goodbye, and retrieved the stolen securities. Holding 6,000 pounds was too much temptation for Twiggs. He killed Maud, taking the securities and the Mouser T-11, and went into hiding. Of course, this did not please Moran, but before he could personally take care of it, he was called to Paris by his master, Moriarty. Adder tried to find Twiggs, and unfortunately for him, he did. He could not talk Twiggs out of his securities. It was no match for Twiggs in a shootout. Twiggs killed Adder with the gun he had taken from Maud. The evidence found at Jacquard's house, the securities, the Mauser, and the Le Franchon, and the Le Franchon, Fauchou, the Fauchou, the Vaux, Hamburg,
stop,
indicate that Jacquard was the probable murderer of Twiggs. Wait, what?
What?
The evidence found at Jacquard's house, the securities, the Mauser, and the Le Fauchou, indicate that Jacquard was the probable murderer of Twiggs.
Ah, interesting.
It all fits together, an all too common tale of dishonesty and betrayal. There is no honor among thieves. Then Moran must have murdered Jacquard, exclaims Lestrade. I'm afraid not, Lestrade, replies Holmes. The story of Jacquard's death was clear from the clues found at his residence. In fact, it was so clear that it clouded my view for a short time of how Jacquard fit into the other murders. As the most recent victim, Jacquard's trail promised to be the warmest, and therefore his residence was the first stop in my investigation. It was replete with clues. The securities, the money, and jewelry found in the apartment implied that robbery was not the motive. Did we not go there?
We must not have, because the securities were there, and the Mauser...
Good gravy.
Whoops.
Well...
What a bunch of fools we are.
I thought we went
We're going to get kicked out of wizard school. You see, Lestrade, Holmes turns his attention to the inspector, if Moran or one of his men had killed Jacquard, the securities would have been taken. If you check with Lindsay and company, I think you'll find that these are the missing securities. No, you can rule out Moran and his organization. Jacquard's death was due not to criminal intrigue, but to his romantic intrigue. I think there's little doubt about what happened on the night of Jacquard's death. The story is told by the physical evidence. After Jacquard killed Twiggs, he still had time to keep his planned engagement. Who was the woman? According to Langdale Pike, and he should know, it was Leticia Garcia. He picked her up at the theater after her performance and took her to his rooms. Upon entering his apartment, he went to the study and removed his coat, relieving himself of the two pistols and tossing the securities on the desk. His summer was successful, for he had soon maneuvered Miss Garcia upstairs to his bedroom. But the evening came to a different climax than Jacquard had expected. Someone kicked his door in and charged upstairs. How did we not go to his place? And do you know who? I mean, we still got it. It's just... Asks Lestrade. No. I think we can assume it was Marco Escobedo. If you check today's times, you will find him and Miss Garcia linked romantically. An old and familiar drama took place. Fight over a woman. Jacquard lost his fight and his life. The jilted lover then dressed Jacquard's body, not showing the same care as the fastidious Jacquard. He then rolled the body up into the bedroom rug and moved it to the Thames. His murderer did not know what an ironic resting place this was, since he knew nothing of Jacquard's involvement in the other murders. Case closed.
Yeah, we
oh my god, he went there
the
first!
Main...
I seriously thought we went there.
Yeah, we definitely
we
not
never went there.
We went to so many places.
Well,
we got two of part one wrong from that so far.
Yeah. Holmes has solved the case by following seven leads. Roland Jacquard, H.R. Murray, the Bagatelle Club, Langdale Pike, Porky Shinwell, the Tankerville Club, and Kathleen Lindsay.
Tankerville, Kathleen Lindsay.
Man.
We went a lot of places. Where, what are they?
I feel the dumbest.
H.R. Murray.
We did so good, and then we botched the one. Whatever. Fine. Mm-hmm.
Bagatelle yeah, Club. Langdale Pike.
We went to Murray. Oh, I already crossed it out.
Okay. Kathleen Lindsay.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
What about Pike?
We got
Pike.
Six of them.
It should be Pike.
Pike? I didn't write
Pike. Langdale Pike. What, does he have a name or whatever? What's
he would have
called?
Been at the Gossip Columnist.
Society Columnist.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
We went to five of those places.
We went to Porky Shinwell.
Yeah.
That was later, I think, so. Oh, wait, was it?
No, I think so.
Oh, yeah. That's oh. Porky right there. Yeah,
you did.
Okay.
Groovy. Okay, well.
Any free ones in addition to those?
No.
Okay, so then we'll have those six crossed off and then seven more removed from whatever the total is after that.
So 21.
Well, hang on.
After those are crossed off.
Who killed Nathan Revell? Cyril Maud and Curtis Twiggs. 10 points.
Okay.
Why? They were ordered to by Colonel Sebastian Moran. 5 points.
Hmm.
We knew that, we just didn't say it.
That's a different... I mean,
yeah.
We gave why the order was given rather than who gave the order.
You know what? I think we got the points.
Me too.
Yeah.
5 points, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, everybody around here knew.
Next up.
Yeah.
Next up.
Who killed Cyril Maud?
Twiggy.
Curtis Twiggs, 10 points. Why?
Mooney.
To take the money for himself, 5
Aha.
points. We did it. Who killed Charles Addard? Curtis Twiggs, 10 points. Why? Self-defense, 5 points. Busted.
What did we put?
We put would have ratted him out.
Yes. We were on the trail, but we didn't get it right.
No, and we didn't get the next one either.
Who was the... No, we did.
Okay.
Who was the person identified as Leo Shepard?
Oh, yeah, we did get that one.
Curtis Twiggs, 10 points.
The next one we get.
Who killed him? Roland Jacquard, 10 points.
No.
Why? To retrieve the securities from Moran, 5 points.
We put for his betrayal, but...
That's not correct.
Nope.
Who killed Roland Jacquard?
The pug.
The pug, 10 points. Why?
No more.
5 points. Were all the murders related? Almost.
Is that what it 15, says?
No, it says no.
Oh.
Which is what we put.
Good. How many points?
15 points.
Nice.
Whew! I think they were really banking on us, assuming that Moran killed Jacquard.
Yeah.
What was the name of the dog that traced Jacquard and Addard's path?
Polo!
What's your guess?
Polo.
Yeah, speaking of Polo.
Barky.
What's your guess, Diana?
Chipper.
Barky.
Toby.
No.
No!
10 points.
That
we don't get.
That dog made Undertale.
Yeah. Thank you, Toby. You did a good job. Polo, you did such a good job. Number two, who killed Nikolai Pokrovsky? Oh, it was Konstantin Jastrow.
Oh.
Of course.
That. Yeah.
It was in the paper.
Of course.
Twice.
Why? Well, we should have read the paper.
Well, it didn't,
but it wasn't connected to anything.
He didn't connect it, but he was just in
Speaking
the paper.
Of which, why was the body of Reinhard Lutz? Oh, I was trying to figure out who Lutz was, and he's literally in the sentence before that.
Yeah, it's a smuggler.
Why was the body of Reinhard Lutz found in a woman's dress? He attended a women's only meeting at the Russian Social Club.
That's why they're all servants. Okay, I got that wrong.
Who killed Lutz? Russian revolutionaries, of course.
Really? We really killed him.
Russian revolutionaries.
Wow, okay.
I have no idea what that's about.
Just
papers, papers, definitely.
But seriously.
Alright, we add up our points. Don't get your hopes up.
Okay.
15.
How many negative points do you get?
Negative
Diana?
70 just on that side already.
Okay.
Let's see. 15,
come 20, on, 20, zero.
40, I can do a little bit better than zero, I think. Let me double check because you threw out a number while I was counting.
200.
Our base score was 80. We lose 70 and have 10.
Hey!
Get the harmonic flag! Yay!
No.
Right there.
I'm gonna do it behind the camera.
Okay.
Let's
I'll everything's on camera.
Yeah, you can see
it's
it.
Not canon. It's behind me. Good game, guys.
Good game.
That was a beast.
That was something.
And we killed 80% of the beasts.
Oh, man. Okay, good game.
Good game.
We did it. We did.
We did the thing.
We did it. Thank you guys so much for hanging out with us. Not a whole lot more of these left. We've got
two
more of these, but we have another game lined
two
up for after that.
Moriartys.
Two
Moriartys. Hey.
Hey. Hey.